This version of It's Eric Nagel has been modified from its original broadcast. Content has been edited to fit this platform.
Hello.
Broadcasting live from beautiful Midtown Manhattan, where, on a clear night, you can hear a show still trying to succeed on an already dead medium. The It's Eric Nagel Show. I'm your announcer, Dennis Falcone. And now, let's introduce your host, two guys who, along with Zia Anderson, that are not Chip and Anthony, Eric Nagel, Brian Gittleman. Laid off 5 years ago, but through some kind of glitch in the payroll department, they still get a paycheck.
Run! Fez!
Run and Fez!
Hey!
Sine wave sweep 32 seconds. 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz at 2 kilohertz per second.
Ezekiel 25:17. The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the iniquities of the selfish and the tyranny of evil men. Blessed is he who in the name of charity and goodwill shepherds the weak through the valley of darkness, for he is truly his brother's keeper and the finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
And boom goes the dynamite.
Show. I'm Ron this fest.
I muted Eric.
You're right there.
Did you mute me, Eric?
I did you before. Hey. You're there now. Hi, buddies.
Hey, buddies.
What a week. What a fucking week.
Yeah, man, this week's kind of sucked.
There's a lot going on. Tornadoes, hurricanes. The West Coast is pretty much all singed. Flooding down south.
Yep.
Can't get people out of Afghanistan. The Taliban's taken over. But the biggest, most tragic news this past week was the passing of our pal Fez Wally.
Yeah, man. Like, I can't tell you the amount of nights that I would just, you know, listen to Ron and Fez, like, working night shift, like, doing jobs, and just, like, just loving Ron and Fez. Like, I miss the Ron and Fez show. Like, when they weren't together at the, towards the end there, like, it was hard.
Yeah, Fez retired in 2015.
Yeah.
So he's been off the air for, like, 6 years. And hearing the Bennington show this week, by the way, the first time that I actually had to sign up for a free trial to get Sirius, because I have not had Sirius since I left.
Like, no one had a code, like a Netflix code, to give Eric. Like,
I didn't
that's
ask.
So hard. I know, but I I just feel like that's hard. I feel like someone would have been like, "Here, just take this."
No, I didn't ask. I was just like, you know what, this is different. I just did the free trial, and then, you know, I'm canceling this week. But yeah, Saturday, getting the news and then seeing the Instagram post about Fez passing really just kind of hit home and thinking about like what you said too, for people working at night, and then when they came over to Satellite, they were your midday show.
Mm-hmm.
That so while you were working during the day, working at night, what over on demand, you could listen to them anytime, and they were a great companion piece for the shit job that you had to do, or schooling, or whatever else was going on in your life. And for me, I mean, being a fan of it on the years at NEW on at night, when I remember when they came to New York, I mean, we were just understanding Opie and Anthony at that time, and then, you know, a few months later, or several months later, Ron and Fez show up, and I knew of Ron from Ron and Ron, because anytime we were down in Florida, I used to hear the Ron and Ron show when I was younger. My uncle loved the Ron and Ron show, and he lived down in the Orlando area. And then when they came up here and with Fez, and they were doing ronandfez.com.
Yeah.
It was the whole, which was like, what is this? And then just hearing Fez's cadence with the way they did things was hilarious. But over time, Ron and Fez became the only show that I could still listen to that I could be a radio fan. Because even though I'm working with ONA, so now I'm working there, I'm not a fan of the show per se, like sitting home and listening to this and enjoying it on a fan level. It's not the same. When we're done with the show, I didn't listen to anything. Like, I'd cut up best ofs, but I never listened to the replays. I didn't listen to any of the programming we put out because I was there while we were doing it. But Ron and Fez was different. We'd finish up, go down the hall, go back to our office. They'd start at 12. And we'd put them on in the office while we were doing work. And when they even have their free FM show years later, they were on, I think, 6 p.m. on New York only on the was the free FM station. And I would be like, I would just be getting back up, you know, sleeping in the afternoon from after work, getting back up. I'd listen to Ron and Fez while making dinner, doing whatever else. So Ron and Fez, even though I got to work next to them, sometimes I worked with them, I filled in here and there when they were shorthanded, was still like the only show I could still be a fan of, a radio fan, to enjoy and appreciate and not know how it's done and not know what the fuck is going on here, because they don't reveal anything.
Nope.
And sometimes they have all this stuff that's going on with these storylines and then they just move on to other things and you go, wait, I forgot about that a couple months ago. What happened with that? Oh, yeah, I don't know. That was the answer you would get if you'd ask someone. Like, there's no conclusion to some of this stuff.
Yeah, like a lot of stuff too. And like, you know, Ron as a host is probably one of my favorite hosts in radio, because he's seamless. Like, he's like almost perfect the way he does things. Like, he'll be talking and he'll be doing an ad and you don't even know that he roped you into an ad, and you're like, shit, he got me again. Like, he's just so good and just like friendly and a personable person, like knows what he's talking about, knows music. Like, he's just a really good dude. And, you know, I've met Fez, I think, two or three times. And I think the last time that I ran into Fez, it was we were doing the It's Eric Nagel show at Sirius.
Right.
And we went into the studio and he was sleeping on the couch. And we were like, dude, you can't be, we have to go now. And he's like, hey,
we had to
shoo him off the couch.
Giddles reminded
me. He's like, can I just sleep here? We're like, I guess.
Giddles reminded me of that the other day. And I totally forgot about that. But as soon as you told me that, I remembered it exactly. Fez had to live at the radios at Sirius for some reason. I forgot what it was, but he was sleeping in their office or in our office, like either one. I think it was ours because we had the couch in our office and they didn't.
Well, you had the couch, but sometimes he would sleep in the studio because your studio at the time was just you guys.
Yeah, it
wasn't
it
like really being shared.
It
had the
yeah.
couches and it had the curtains, so you could just close it up and no one would know you were in there.
Yeah, I forgot all about that, but I remember he was like, but it wasn't a problem. I said, like, Fez could have stayed if he wanted to, but he's like, no, then he gets up and does his own thing. And it'd be weird, too. Sometimes we'd come in on the weekends when we were still doing it on set. Before we went back to Fridays, we were doing it on Saturday nights for a bit. We'd come in and Fez would be there.
Yeah.
Like, he would be on there working. And hey, Fez, what are you doing? Oh, just getting some work done. He's sorting through things. It's not like he wasn't doing anything. He was doing stuff. But he told me, he said, well, his laptop wasn't working that well, or his computer at home wasn't working that well, so he just comes into the office on the weekends to do his work. And I was like, that guy makes pretty good money. Why doesn't he just get better computers? But I think he just didn't like being in his apartment. Like, I think anytime he could get out and be anywhere else is where he wanted to be.
I don't blame him. Like, after a year of, like, lockdown here, like, anytime I can get out of the house, I'm happy to.
Right.
Like, so if he was in a situation where, you know, maybe he needs to get out, like, I'd totally get that. Like, you know, be in a place where you can run into people and you can talk to people. If you need beverages, there is all the free beverages you could have. Like, it's pretty good to live at Sirius. Like, you get all the potato chips and snacks. Lots of stuff.
All the containers of pretzels.
Yeah, it's awesome.
See, that was another thing, too, that since you mentioned that, I remember for the Ron and Fez show, it was either Pepper, Chris Stanley, or the interns, whatever, would come back with these coffee cups filled with the pretzel rods. And it wasn't just like they had them there so they could all enjoy. Ron had a cup. Fez had a cup. Chris had a cup. Earl had a cup. Like, everyone had their own cup just packed full of these pretzel rods. There was two factions that I saw really took full advantage of the stuff in the kitchen from Sirius XM. One was Artie Lang. If I'd see him in the morning when he was still there. He would get cans, like two or three, almost like if he was standing on the corner of a ring and somebody was just hucking the beers like Stone Cold at him, he had a bunch of Hawaiian Punch.
Oh, man, those are so sweet.
So he had like three Hawaiian Punches, and then he'd buy a couple bags of M&Ms. And then, like, we'd be in there getting coffee or what have you, and we'd see Artie, and always very nice, never a dick to anybody, but he's just in there, like hitting the machine, sliding his thing through, and then walks in like that. That's breakfast for Artie. So that was one. But the other was always all the pretzels. If you ever wonder where they all went, they were all in the Ron and Fez studio.
I'm not going to lie. I would take as many of those pretzels as I could every time. Because, like, for people who don't know, it's not like a cup of pretzels. Like, it was a gigantic tub, like, this big, filled with pretzel rods.
Yeah, the big, clear, keg things. Yeah.
Yeah, so you'd take, like, the big 16-ounce coffee cups that were there. You'd fill a coffee cup with as many of those things as you can. And then you'd take another cup, and you'd cover them so that people wouldn't see what a fatty you are taking an entire cup of, like, 40 pretzels to the studio.
Right.
And then you have to, like, hold all your seltzers. Yeah, it was great.
Yeah. I know you were on one of the homeless shopping sprees with, not like a contestant, but you were there with me. You were filming with Steve C. I think that was the first one we did when we came to XM. I think 2005 you were there.
It was sometime around there.
Were you there for the other one where we had Fez with us for the homeless shopping spree?
No, I was only there for the one when they tried to leave us at the mall.
Right. Which was so stupid because we were right near the bus. So they're like, oh, let's get out of here.
Yeah, that was part of the bit, Eric. They were trying to leave us at the mall.
Ben's an asshole. You know, yeah. Ben was like, oh, we got to leave. And they're saying the air. And then somebody's telling me, oh, yeah, they're saying you got to leave. I was like, okay, well, we're right here. We got right on the bus. And then Ben's like, oh, the fuck? Who told? It's like, you said it over the air, idiot.
Yeah, we heard you.
Yeah,
dummy.
We heard you. No, so the one year I want to say it's the first one we did when we went back to CBS, had this split CBS XM venture, and we were doing the whole, you know, to-do on the CBS end about the homeless shopping spree, talking to the homeless people, and who were going to be, like, the celebrity spotters for the homeless people, and Ron and Fez were there with us, and, we thought they were just like they were going to participate, like Fez was going to be a sponsor, or I'm the spotter for all of this. I got to find that audio because I'm trying to see if I remember this correctly. And then something happened where all of a sudden Ron announced that Fez was going to be one of the homeless people that we need. He was going to be a fill-in.
Oh,
so
my
then
God.
Fez was walking around with us as one of the homeless people. And this is when the news came to shoot us. Like, they did it every year. They would take video footage of us in the mall. But this year, like, CNN, BBC International, all of these big outlets were taking B-roll and photos and stuff. And every piece of footage you saw from that year, when they were speaking of the homeless, focused on Fez. He was wearing this, like, black jacket and a white... there's a photo. Let me see if I can find the photo.
Yeah, it's weird. He kind of, like... Because the thing is, he didn't look homeless. Yeah. He almost looked like he was undercover, which, I mean, he technically was. Like, he was not supposed to be there as a homeless person.
Right. Let me see if...
But do you have that picture? Like, I thought you posted it on the Twitter this week. But maybe
I'm
wrong.
I didn't post this one. Okay, I think I found it here.
Hold God, I forgot about all that, all those with Tippy Tom and half a Hulk face and, like, all those people.
Oh, yeah, that's and then the guy who thought he was an Indian chief.
Yeah.
I forgot his name. He had his recorder and a little drum thing with him. I think this is it right here. Hold on. There it is. So
Yeah, that's the one. It looks like he's just, you know, going to be on a no-fly list at the airport.
Yeah. So, I don't have the chat up here. I should put them up, but this, let's see what Cowbot said here. Nope, that's the promotion. Don't want to do that. Fez was definitely dressed for the occasion. Yes, he was.
Yeah.
So he's, all right, so he's not wearing a white t-shirt. It's like a heather gray shirt. I'm looking at it. So that was the official Homeless Shopping Spree ONA t-shirt that we put out for this event. And on the back of it was the evolution of man. You would see like from a primeval, I don't know, some kind of weird thing evolving into some sort of ape creature. And then it's standing up, evolving into a human, and then going back down into a homeless guy pushing a shopping cart. Can't do that now. It's very, oh, it was tasteless. It's still funny, but... he was wearing that shirt. He's got this jacket, and he's not. I guess he does look homeless. I never thought he did, but now I'm staring at this. I can see now why CNN and BBC were fixated on this. So he
looks like how I picture an undercover Canadian cop. Like that's what I picture when I see him like that. like where are you going, buddy? You're like, oh no.
Like he's walking around as one of the young people in the record store to see the ones who were shoplifting.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good record.
So Fez became pretty much the face of the homeless shopping spree when I know he didn't want to. But Fez was great for everything. There were times there's another video where they broke in. We were doing this radio war thing at the time where it was a fake radio war between ONA and Ron and Fez. And we had our interns going up against Eastside Dave. And one day we're doing the show, and out of nowhere, Ron and Fez burst into the studio in the morning. Dave's screaming, whatever. Fez strips off his clothes into some kind of outfit and hops on the stripper pole in the corner and starts doing a routine while we're live on the air. There's nothing that they wouldn't do for the joke, for the bit. I even found this, too. Do you remember that the whole radio war thing that was going on?
A little bit of it.
Where Cream Pie Jones had to take the poop out of the toilet and put a little duty hat on it.
Yeah, see, I don't think so. Because like when the serious days happened, like I wasn't listening as much. Like once I wasn't living with you at the time because right. I didn't have Sirius and I didn't subscribe. So like once I moved out, like I basically kind of stopped listening at that point.
Wait a minute, Rock, is that true? Access. This is the first picture on his Wikipedia. Oh my God.
Jack Black could easily play Fez in a movie. Yes, 100%.
He could. You know who else looks like Fez right now? Or not right now, but looks now like what Fez used to look like.
There you go.
Kevin Nash, the wrestler. If you look at a photo of him now, big, bushy, white and gray beard and the hair, he just looks jacked. He looks like a jacked Fez. I'll see if I can find that photo, too.
Yeah, I don't know too many wrestlers.
He was part of the NWO. He was Big Daddy Cool Diesel in the WWE. No, not ringing any bells.
Dude, I didn't watch a lot of wrestling. I stopped around like the Bushwhackers time, like so I don't remember too much of like I don't know too much about wrestling.
Let me see if this is
But I know that it's real, or at least it's real to some people, damn it.
Maybe I saw it on his Twitter. It's not on his Instagram. I'm looking for it. But yeah, he looks like a jacked Fez.
Funny.
Oh, poor Fezzy. But anyway, so we were doing the radio war. And so, yeah, we had Cream Pie Jones doing the duty hat thing. Then Pat Duffy did something with, like, hot sauce in his asshole. And then you know how Dave is. Dave will do anything almost to the brink of death for a bit, for anything, to carry favor, to support a radio show, to keep a bit going. And it's one of Dave's strengths and weaknesses at the same time. Like
he's like the Steve-O of radio for the most part. He's just like, yeah, I'll do that. And then Baby Fez Bird came running or whatever.
I think. Oh, this is the photo. Is this the photo? That is the photo. All right, I'm gonna open that up so you guys can see it. But yeah, if they do a movie, if you have Jack Black in like the heart attack years, and then all of a sudden you go alternate timeline, and then Fez all of a sudden is just like a Marvel superhero. This is what he would look like here.
Let's see this, Eric.
I'm trying to. Sorry.
You're building this up. Don't let me down.
There it is. You don't think he looks like Fez?
Maybe a little bit. Like, it looks like Clint Eastwood got really fat to be Santa. Like, that's who that looks like.
Well, Kevin Nash is far from fat, my friend. He's pretty jacked. He's like almost 7 foot tall.
Well, I just meant fat because Clint Eastwood's just like kind of old and scrawny, so anything bigger than him is fat, but yes.
Well, anyway, well, Radio Wars was another great bit with the Ron and Fez show and with Fezzy, and I found this thing. Do you remember Sleeves? Do you remember Sleeves? He would make all those weird songs for Ron and Fez. He talked like, he sounded like if Frasier was British.
I don't know if I remember Sleeves.
Right. Well, I found this, so for the audience may remember this thing here. Hang on.
Radio Wars has requested it's Eastside Dave of Ron and Fez versus Cream Pie Jones of Foe and A of the Mayonnaise Hat and the Trouble DNA.
Radio Wars!
See Dave pick up a stewy shit.
Game on!
Radio Wars!
Are you ready to look at your dream maker? Say you're ready!
Radio Wars!
My boy, Eastside Dave, shit in that hole.
Radio
and dive in deep.
I shit and I shut. I shut your fucking down. Lick my shit. Shit and shut.
I'm panicking here, I know.
If Pat takes a shit,
Radio War!
And he eats it,
fuck.
That would put him well
fuck!
Ahead.
I hate
well
losing. Ahead.
I'm a man who fucked jelly and put a bagel in my rear.
We put shit on our Jared's head yesterday.
That took hot sauce in the asshole.
Dude, he picked up a load of shit that Jimmy sprayed out of his ass that looked like Dinty Moore's beef stew. And picked it up with his hands.
Game on! That's right!
Radio Wars has requested it's Eastside Dave of Ron and Fez versus Cream Pie Jones of Foe and A of the Mayonnaise Hat and the Trouble DNA.
Radio Wars!
I'm fucking shitting in my pants as we speak!
Goddamn it.
Fuck! Fuck! Fuck!
Do something, Cream Pie!
Going through a lot of my archive to see what shit I had from everything, and finding some of this shit, this stuff here, I was just like, oh my god, I can't believe I have this,
dude. So much stuff, dude. So you have like all the archives for everything. You're sitting on like, you know, you're the vault that Disney would lock all the VHSs in.
Buy it now because it's gonna go away, and who knows when it's gonna come back.
Yeah, listen to the show now. It's going in that, on a DAT tape and going in that vault forever.
You've seen the vault room. You've seen what it's.
There's an actual vault. Yes, yeah. I've been in there. Like, there's a real vault in Eric's basement. I do not say that joking.
Here's another one I found.
When Mighty Horse rocks, he rocks a fat ass. When Mighty Horse rocks, he rocks a fat ass.
I was trying to remember the story about Mighty Horse. It was something about a guy who was graffitiing stuff all over the place, and then Ron just started... I don't know what Mighty Horse came from, because even finding the origin bit, I still didn't fully understand. And then he was saying Mighty Horse rocks the D-sippers, which is their version of saying, like, chicks, dick suckers and stuff on the FM, because you couldn't say that stuff. And there was a lot of that this past week. There was a lot of going back through old bits and hearing origin stuff or stuff that you forgot, like revisiting Cake Horn, which is probably their most infamous bit by accident. And it went for an hour plus, and then a next day, and then they revisited it a year later. There was an anniversary that they did for Cake Horn. And going through, and you're laughing, and then as soon as it's done, you're like, oh fuck, I'm back in reality again. And then you start getting upset that it got that,
like, so many reoccurring bits. I think with Fez, what was the one about the girlfriend in Toronto?
Oh, his girlfriend's up in Niagara Falls, Canada.
Or Niagara Falls, Canada.
They're
yes.
engaged and very much in love.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was always a good running bit.
There was a bit too where eventually he broke up with her and started dating Anthony's sister, Dawn.
Yeah, I remember that.
And he just kept calling her to the same title. He's like, Dawn Cumia, Anthony's sister. Like, he kept saying that all the time. And there's a bit where he's trying to play this love song to express his feelings to Dawn. And they had Soundboard Fez, where it was just all these clips of Fez saying,
hey.
Just terrible stuff. Like, there's seven dicks in my ass and there's always room for eight. You know, like, you'd be playing those kind of things over the love song and Fez would be screaming. It's like, stop doing that. Stop with Soundboard Fez. So while Fez is trying to do this love dedication to Dawn Cumia, Rotten is just playing all this horrific stuff. And You can't express enough the brilliance of that show, but also the stupidity of that show. Like, it was just so dumb.
It's great.
But on a whole other level of being dumb. Like, you're sitting there like, this is so fucking stupid, and they're going to keep doing it. And now it's built into a comedy pyramid.
Comedy pyramid.
And then they'd go through, like, another hour of callers topping this same bad joke. It would go really good, and then they would, like, everything would go down for a little while. And then stop being funny, and then somebody called in with another thing, and there they go again for another half hour with this stuff. And it's a compliment. It's so dumb, but on a genius level, that show.
Yep, Old Nerdy is correct. Commitment to the bit. That's what it is. You gotta be pot committed on this shit. Like, you have to go into it and just be like, yep, this is the bit. We are going with it. I've done that numerous times when people did not know they were in a bit. It's gone for hours. It's been hilarious. Was not on radio. I think that's called gaslighting, but it was funny.
Yeah, what's a radio bit is now gaslighting people.
Yeah.
they would do bits like where they would, it was something about getting a tattoo, or he had to grow out his mustache or shave his head, or he had to paint himself as gold dust and he'd walk through Times Square. Or when he did Baby Hitler, he lost a bet and he had to dress like Hitler in a diaper and walk through Times Square doing that.
Yeah, someone mentioned that in the chat earlier. Oh, I was just like, I forgot all about that.
Do you remember? Oh, here's another thing where they made news. So years ago, Andrew WK was doing some kind of drum marathon in a storefront in Times Square. And I think he was playing for like 24 hours straight, and they were videotaping everything. It was for some charity, I believe. But they also had a live, like one of those Earth cams where you could just log in and then stream and at any time and see what's going on. So I think for one show they had Fez just go out there with one of those tourist foam Statue of Liberty crowns.
Oh, yeah.
And he's just sitting there, standing there right behind. He's maybe 6 feet from Andrew WK, but Andrew's got the drums and everything. He's looking this way. Fez is over here just on the phone with Ron. He's just staring at the glass for 3 hours. There's nothing that show
so
would
good.
Do.
So good. And you know, the thing that sucks about it is that, like, all of these bits and all this great stuff happened before the iPhones and the cell phones, whereas like now we would have all these great clips and be like, oh, let's pull up that clip of it, but we just have the audio, like we don't have the video, because you still had to have a bulky like almost shoulder video camera to walk around when all this shit was happening. Like, it kind of sucks.
Yeah, the best part, Chronos74 is saying, best part was how some of the things you never knew if it was a bit or not.
Yeah.
If you did not listen to Bennington's show on this past Monday, which was August 16th. Go back and find it on, you can get the free trial from Sirius, but go on there and go on demand and listen to it. It is one of the most emotional, heart-wrenching shows you'll ever listen to, but also had a lot of funny moments. They were revealing some things that you swear to God was fake and they turned out to be real, and then other things that you swore were real and turned out to be fake.
Like the moon landing?
That's both.
Ooh.
It happened, but it didn't. Not together. It wasn't that moon. It was a totally different moon.
That's no moon.
Yeah, they didn't tell you. Exactly. Death Star dead. They were talking about, there was a bit where it was something where Fez owed everybody a steak dinner, and he went to Steak and Shake and got a bunch of burgers and stuff, brought that in. And the whole staff went apeshit on him because they thought they were going to go get, you know, like a Smith and Walensky's or Capital Grill kind of steak dinner.
Yeah, like a nice steak. Like,
and he brought
steak
and Shake burgers in, and they were losing their shit because he said this, you know, a burger is, he was equating a burger to a steak, saying this is a steak. This counts. They're from Steak and Shake, so they're steak burgers.
It's called steak.
And this was a huge blow up for a while on the show. And then, you know, for years, everyone's like, how does one associate that? And then you find out now that it was a complete work, that it was just total. And like, but they kept it going that long. Mm-hmm. And you'll never see a show ever like this again, or not even a show, but like any kind of comedy group. Nobody could keep things so close to the vest and then just never reveal for the, like, they weren't looking for the admiration for doing what they did. They didn't want the reveal of like, oh, you know, it was my idea. I want the praise and the acceptance and all that stuff. They would do something and then tuck it off to the side and never mention it again. Meanwhile, everyone else is freaking out like, what am I listening to? What really happened here? Nobody's giving me an answer. And it was never important to them to reveal any of that stuff. They just kept going on to the next thing and on to the next thing.
You'll it's like Wizard of Oz. You don't look behind the curtain. You know what I mean? Just like
you'll never see or hear a show like that ever again.
Nah.
Never. Because there's nobody.
It was just such a unique show.
It was an anomaly. Both of them.
It was just so good, yeah.
Yeah, that they played off each other so well, and they just knew what to do. And some of the best things were just, like, they planned a lot of stuff out and very well. But then also other elements would come in where it would just totally change what they had on the script for all of this. Like Cake Horn. He meant to either say, you know, shut your cake hole or pie hole, or, you know, shut your horn, I heard is another term, but he mixed it all together, and he was complaining about management sending an email around to one of our bosses for being upset that Fez would hang around the remember the performance area by the lobby in Sirius. Mm-hmm. So he'd be there and he would go and talk to publicists to try
the fish
to get
tank area
to try to get people to come on Unmasked or Bennington or whatever projects they were working on. And he was trying to make it about that. And when he said Cake Horn, they kept focusing on Cake Horn. And then Fez said something along the lines that the point of this is not the Cake Horn. And Ron goes, no, that focus is the Cake Horn. They don't care what the complaint is now. You said something stupid and we're going to keep going with this.
Yep. That's honestly, like, one of the best bits is when someone says something stupid and then you just rail them for it forever. Cake Horn.
Old Nerdy says, wonder why former employees or interns never spilled the beans. The interns never knew. The interns never knew any of this stuff was going on. Like, they'd have the setups, but, like, the real reveals or the real motives behind anything they were doing, the interns didn't know. Sometimes half the staff didn't know. Like, only the people that were the crucial to executing this stuff knew, which was Ron and then whoever else.
Yeah.
You know, and Fez. And past that point, nobody else needed to know. Like, some of those things were just Ron, Fez, and Eastside Dave. Earl didn't know half the time. The interns didn't know. Why would they tell the interns? Why would you tell anybody?
Yeah, you don't need to. The more people you don't tell it to, the easier it is to just keep that thing going. Like, first rules of conspiracies, don't tell a lot of people.
Right. joining us right now is Big Ass Card Holder 1969. That is Zia.
Hoo-ah!
Hi.
Hi, Zia. How are you?
Good. How are you guys?
Oh, I miss my Big Ass Card. I used to have one.
I did,
What's
too.
Big Ass Card?
Big Ass Card was sort of like what they do in New York, your
That's
union.
What they're doing.
Your union membership card,
yeah,
right? Or like you see now on Instagram, SAG-AFTRA. They always have stories of people posting the card. I got my first SAG-AFTRA card for doing this job. I'm an actor now. So it was a take on the old union cards. I guess like Teamsters or something. You would have your local chapter cards. So that's what it was when they stopped doing RonandFez.com and just doing Ron and Fez nights on NEW. They started putting out these big ass card holders, and then had a number on there printed out, and you would call in and say, "Hey, buddies, big ass card holder 4356."
Hoo-ah!
And he would like, "Oh, checking in," and then you would say whatever you want. It was just an old school thing that they would do. It was just a way to get people to feel involved, to feel like they're part of this, like this is their show too.
And also, like, the excitement when someone would call in with, like, a really low number on their big-ass card. It was like, ooh, like, someone who had, like, one of the first phone numbers. Be like, big-ass card, to hold their number 110. They're like, oh, shit. Like, this guy's an old person. Yeah, exactly. Like, by the end, it was just like, caller number 10,204. It wasn't
it's like
the
Simpsons bit. It's like, what's your social security number? One.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like you were the first guy because you've been around forever. Hi, Zia. We're talking about Ron and Fez and the passing of Fez Wiley, and it was very hard to deal with. It's still kind of, you're fine in times, and then you read things online about people who loved him, and then tuning into the Bennington show all week. Something new comes up and you're like, I can't handle this right now. It's still so upsetting.
Well, it's just hard when it hits this close to home. You know what I mean? Like, it's just we all knew Fez. Well, Z didn't, but like, you know, we for years.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just weird. It's just different because, you know, most people when like and I'm not saying like, you know, nothing against Fez, but when like a major like big celebrity like passes away, you get like all this stuff, but like, you know, you're not close to that, and like you can sympathize with it, but like this is something that's just like, this is close, this is local, and like, you know, it hurts. You have an actual connection to it, someone you've interacted with a lot. It's not just like, you know, somebody that you've like run into, you know, one or two times and they're nice. Like, he was always a good person, and it sucks losing a friend. That's what it comes down to, you know.
It does.
Yeah, it's always sad.
I've been around Fez for 11 years. Their whole satellite run, their Free FM run, some of the NEW run, I was around there for that. And then, you know, when the whole ONA thing exploded in 2002, and Ron and Fez were there for another few months before they decided to kill the talk format in New York and sent them down to JFK. And it was hard hearing them on JFK because, look, this is 2003. Infinity Broadcasting, which was CBS Radio, was not a fan of streaming any of the radio stations. Like, they just didn't. Clear Channel was streaming since, I think, 99, 2000. But anything CBS, anything Infinity, never was streaming. So if you were out of the market, you couldn't just listen to it. They didn't have on-demand and podcasts and all that stuff then. And
no, that's what I'm saying. Like, this stuff is, like, you know,
that's less than 20 years ago. You know, it's not even that long ago. And that's the thing. So it was hard to hear them when they were on JFK. You know, unless somebody sent me, you know, at the time dating yourself, but like they'd burn CDs or something for you, or they found a way to do like some kind of mega transfer thing where they could finally do an MP3 when that was feasible, to hear that stuff. Otherwise, I was hearing the JFK years after the fact, just because I wasn't in the area. I was in New York and I was in West Palm Beach, so I couldn't really do anything.
So, like, is there any place where all these old archives are up currently, or no? Oh,
they're all over YouTube.
Okay, yeah, I didn't know if there was like a streaming service or something like that had them all, like an old thing other than YouTube, or if that's something that Ron would like to do. Because I'm just saying, I could use some work. I could digitize all these old things. I will digitize all these old episodes and put them up.
Fair point. There's a lot of fans. Totally listen there's to a lot that. Of episodes. There's not everything, but there's a lot of stuff up on YouTube right now. Same thing with the ONA stuff. Like, ONA never had their archives. I had their archives, but it wasn't worth, like, I put up what I can, but it's not worth digitizing. Oh, it's all digitized. It's not worth posting all of that stuff in some sort of subscription format or whatever, because the fans were just constantly taping the shows every day and then throwing them up on YouTube. So what good is it going to do if some video's been up there for like 11 years and then you try to go, oh, you could buy the high quality version for, you know, for $2 an episode? They'd be like, no, I'll just listen to the YouTube version. Why? What do I care?
Or just go back and just edit all the storylines together, like the way you could watch different things in different orders. You know what I mean? You could watch like the X-Files, just the lore episodes, and it makes sense. You could watch.
We were talking about that the other night.
Yeah, just connect all the ones that work together.
I just want
and do like one long cut.
I just want the whole series of X-Files where it's either about the, you know, Mulder's missing sister, and the black oil. Everything else, I don't give a shit about. Cut all that stuff out. I don't care. But if you can just give me the episodes in order of that storyline, that's all I'd rather watch.
Yeah.
But anyway, Godspeed, Fez Whatley. We have to move on. Zia, how are you? You were in Manhattan today. How's everything?
Oh, it was good. I just went to, we did Chip at Gas Digital again, and it was at 4:30. And coming back, it first said it was only going to take about an hour, a little bit over an hour. It shouldn't have taken that long.
Right.
And then it rerouted us like three fucking times and had us go like all the way around and then back to where we started completely unnecessarily. And then going through the Holland Tunnel, we got fucking stuck. And then, of course, right after that, it clears right up.
This was routing you around in Manhattan?
Yeah, it routed us around. Where did it take us, Nick? It took us like...
the same place?
Well, you said it was taking us back to where we started.
No.
Well, there was like a Times Square bomb threat today, so maybe that fucked with traffic.
There was?
Yeah, did you guys not watch the news?
There
was a guy outside the Capitol of Library of Congress today with the bomb live streaming in his car. And then at that time, there was another person in Times Square with the bomb. And then there was another one somewhere else in the country with the bomb. So that
probably... I didn't see that at all.
Yeah, it was all over the news today.
Times Square.
So that probably affected the traffic.
That, yeah, that definitely didn't help. Not good at all. Yeah, it ended up being like not, it ended up being a lot longer than it originally said it was going to be, but it also took us around a couple areas. Like it just took us.
It would have been the same time.
Nick's saying it's saying it would have been the same time. I don't know.
I don't know. Driving into the city is just a nightmare. I don't do it unless I literally need a car in the city because it's just, it sucks. Like, it's just, it's easier to drive to the path than just take the path in.
Half the time I got to drive in is because I got to come in through the Lincoln Tunnel, take 34th Street all the way down to the Midtown Tunnel in order to go to Brooklyn, to Long Island, to wherever I need to go. So sometimes I have to cut through Manhattan because going around above and below is way more expensive and takes a lot more time.
Yeah. That, I mean, that makes sense. But like, yeah, it just sucks. Like, there's just so much traffic. Everyone's driving in now. You go on the subway, it's empty. It's like, dude, this place is like, everything is just covered in bleach. Like, it's so safe to be on the subway.
What was that noise? Is there ice cream man around?
I wish. I did see the ice cream man driving today. Every time I see him, I'm like, is it inappropriate for me to flag down the ice cream man?
Because most of them are selling also, you know, drugs with it. So if you're waving them down, they're thinking, oh, cool, I'm going to get a sale. And it's like, oh, no, she wanted a Flintstones push-up. What a waste. Why did I pull over on the side of the Garden State Parkway for this?
Yeah.
I actually just want the Mario with the bubblegum nose. Thank you.
There you go.
Oh, man. The best thing about those is if they ever started to slowly melt, it was just like, here's Super Mario if he opened the Ark of the Covenant. So he's like eyeballs falling out. He looked like
dripping everywhere.
From Goonies. Yeah, he's just all melty.
How was your night, Zia? I had in the middle of the night 4 consecutive tornado warnings to seek shelter.
That's so nothing down here. Nothing. That's so insane that you got. I guess it was just up in like Northern Jersey. The last time you got the tornado warning, we got the tornado warning as well. But nothing happened.
Yeah.
We got that as well. But this time, nothing. You got 4 in the middle of the night.
Around 2 o'clock, one around 3. Because they would say the first one, I think, was like 2 o'clock and it said till about 2:30 was the warning. 2:30 would come around and you're like, okay, that's fine. 5 minutes later, the thing went off again. And you know, it's that alarm for like the Amber
Alert. Like an Amber Alert.
Or the, you know, aliens or nuclear bomb went off and, you know, that kind of stuff.
Waiting for the aliens. One day we're going to look at our phone. It's going to be blaring and it's going to be a fucking alien invasion.
I'll wake up in the middle of the night and it'll just say aliens were fucked. And I'll be like, thank God it wasn't one of those stupid Amber Alerts. And I don't have to turn it off. I'll actually get up and look out the window, you know?
Yeah, there's been 50,000 people abducted. They're in a flying circular disc license plate. I can't really read that language. If you've seen it, last seen on Broadway and 3rd, like, we don't know where it's going.
The alarm's going off and you go, that opening to Independence Day, it's happening now.
That's what I was going to say. The opening to Independence Day where you just see the shadow moving over.
Yeah.
Oh. Fire in the sky.
God. So, I'm waiting for it. It's going to happen at some point.
I welcome it at this point. I welcome our ant overlords. But I had 4 tornado alerts. So like after 5 minutes after the warning time would go off, it would go off again. So this went from 2 a.m. to about 4:15, 4:30, somewhere there. Yeah. So I don't know what to do. I got a newborn, so I got to go grab the kid and take her downstairs and then try to corral all the pets and stuff. But look, you could say I'm overreacting, but this doesn't happen in the New York City suburbs. It doesn't happen like this. And this is the second time within 3 weeks that we might as well just be living in Nebraska at this point. You know,
I mean, next time you go down to the basement, next time you go down to the basement for one of these tornado warnings, you just have to do an impromptu "It's Eric Nagel" possible tornado episode, and just do it every single time because that's where you are right now in your basement. Correct?
No.
Maybe I'll have to do that. But I
you need like a graphic, and it's just like the spinning thing, and like you like that? Like the baby in the tornado. And you're like,
I put everyone downstairs, right? And I kept going outside the front to look. Most of the time, there was no rain. You just walk out, and it felt like the world was burning because it was just sauna hot. You walk out the front door, thick humidity, burning heat, very little wind, and then all of a sudden major gusts and then little wind, like back and forth. But there was barely any rain with all of this. And each time it went off, I go, all right, well, I'm going to go back outside and take a look. And I'm looking at the clouds. They're moving pretty fast, so I'm expecting to see something or hear something. Everyone says when it touched down, it sounds like a like one of those freight trains where in the Midwest or down south, where if you hit the railroad lights, you're there for at least 20 minutes as a train's going by.
Oh my God, yeah.
And there was nothing. I was in a way disappointed. I was relieved, but in a way disappointed. I'm like, this just wasted my time.
I always hated that. So we had a lot of hurricanes and storms and things like that growing up in Hawaii. And I remember, I think it was 2000, we had a storm that it was like an insane flood. Like we got stuck at home. It washed out pieces of road, was taking trucks down, like trucks that thought they could pass through the rivers. And that got taken down. Like one of those crazy fucking huge ones. Gravestones were found in soccer fields like 2 miles away. Like just an insane
turns out
one
that
like
was
that.
Just a prank that happened to happen at the same time the tornado did. It's like the tornado really didn't uplift that graveyard and dump it on the on the kids' little league field. That was just a prank just by a prank. Local hoodlums.
Yes. Well, we should get a lot of those.
Yes.
But I always we had a lot of storms like that.
Washington's head.
There's a skeleton that slid at home plate with his hand on the base, so he's safe.
Yeah. And he's safe.
Well, now.
You were saying,
but yeah, it was we had a lot of storms and stuff like that, and they were always kind of exciting. I don't know, I always liked them when I was a kid. It was fun. You know, it's never good when pieces of road are washed away, but it was always one of those things where it's like, we're gonna have a big storm, and you're like hunkered down and you're ready for it, and then it just turns out it's a little bit of rain and you're like, oh well, that fucking sucked. Like it is kind of a letdown. Like you don't want there to be devastation around, but it's still like you're waiting for it, you're ready, there's that anticipation, and then just nothing happens and you're like, all right.
Because yeah, cool. I think it's like, you're like, if they're going to disrupt my day like this, there better be a fucking storm. Like, don't tell me like
I can't
do shit today and then you're not going to storm? Bullshit. Like,
it wasn't so much like I had stuff to do because I was just, you know, doing what I do every night, Pinky, trying to take over the world. And this happened and I was like, I'll take you through it. So I'm here doing some work. That thing goes off. And that thing, you know, the fucking panic, the end of the world alerts going on. Mm-hmm. And I hit it and I stopped for a second. I look and I went, shit, I'm going to have to wake her up, which the kid's sleeping fine. That's what I was thinking. Not that worst. Tornado is here. Something's going to happen. It was, damn it, I'm going to have to wake her up. So when I ran to get her, I had to get a diaper and a bottle. So I brought her down here, did the change, feeding and everything, and then got her back to sleep. So while waiting down here for the damn tornado stuff to stop alerting me and be done, she was already asleep. So I just kind of picked her up and put her right back to bed. But that was my big concern. It's like, I didn't want to have to deal with her being awake right now. I didn't want to be awake at that time, but I had stuff to do.
And this was what time? Like 4 in the morning?
Two something in the morning when that first alarm hit. Yeah. So, normally, I wouldn't have cared, but two factors. One, she's a newborn, so I have to, you know, act like that. But then two, this is North Jersey. We're like, I can see Manhattan from the down my road. Like, I can go out in the middle of the road. I'm like, oh, there's the skyline. It's there. It shouldn't happen here. You know,
yeah.
You shouldn't be getting these fucking finger of God alerts. And then so you kind of have to take it seriously. But then I looked out, nobody on my block was down in the, I said none of the lights were on, no, they all just slept through it. And then I was looking
everybody's
online
like
today
quiet.
Everyone's like, oh, it was just a watch. Other people are like, no, it said said seek shelter, these were full warnings, and everyone just said fuck it and went to sleep. I probably should have done the same thing,
yeah,
but I did not.
Well I remember when me and you when me and you were living together and we had that tornado that hit Bay Ridge area.
No, we weren't living together at that point.
Oh, that's
point.
Right. I moved.
You
out.
Moved
I
and around, I moved.
Yeah, right? We moved around the corner from
each other. Because here's what happened. I saw. Remember, I think I wrote you that morning because we were on the air doing O&A. Yeah. And where we had on the one of the big screens there was ABC7, which is the local ABC affiliate here in New York. And they're showing about this Brooklyn tornado thing. And they're getting we were doing a bit. Anthony was doing, like, you know, Travolta and Sinatra as in Twister, like storm hunters coming to Brooklyn. And then they started getting the helicopter shots. And I'm looking, I go, that's where we lived. That's that's my apartment. That's where, right? Like, it was the, it was like, here's our row of our brownstones. Cross the street, that's where it hit.
Yeah, it's crazy. There was, like, even, like, I think it was almost like two apartments down. There was, like, something that went through one of the front of the buildings, which, where Eric was, it would have been his room if it was two buildings over. Like, yeah. It was pretty nuts. And I remember, because the storm was such an anomaly and people weren't used to it, like, the buses weren't working, the subway shut down. I had to take a ferry to get to work, which is just fucking bizarre, like, having to take a ferry in the city to get from Brooklyn to the city. But I remember it felt like a scene from The Walking Dead. Because we're just a bunch of people who just confused because a tornado just hit Brooklyn. We're on a ferry. We just see smoke from fires rising, helicopters everywhere, and the boats pushing off. I'm like, is this how The Walking Dead starts? Like, what is happening? Like, it was just such an apocalyptic scene. It was crazy.
The end of the world as we know it.
More like a, basically. Yeah, Iraqolypse.
It feels like it. No, I make that joke every time. The Iraqolypse. Yeah. Nice open to say.
Yeah. The Iraqolypse. It says it's going to show up. Doesn't make it to the theater in time.
Decides to go home. What, you see it touch tornado down, and then it turns around and just goes away.
It's halfway down. It's like, yeah, I've got to go. Comes right back up.
All these natural disasters, they meant to do something, but something else screwed it up and then never happens.
Yeah.
But, well, we have that, and then now Sunday, we have part, not the full thing, but we have part of this hurricane that's going to hit on Sunday morning, where the majority of the hurricane's hitting the east end of Long Island, and then it's going up through Rhode Island, Massachusetts, and that part of the country. But the bands, the outer bands, are spread so wide that I was watching the news before we were doing the show, and they said, well, here's the projections for Sunday, and you see this heavy rain band where it's like an out, like a borderline of green and then full of red in the middle, which is never good. Just all of a sudden comes slamming right up the Jersey Shore, right in through Manhattan, and all the parts north and southeast and west of the city. So I said, all right, so Sunday's going to be a video game day, because there's nowhere to go or to do at that point.
Yeah, I mean, we were looking at stuff this week, too, and it's going to be, even where we're at, it's just going to be raining all week.
Right.
It's just all week is not exactly storm, but just raining. It's one of those weeks where you're like, it's not doing shit.
But it's not going to affect our Saturday plans. Are you still coming out?
We're still coming up.
Yay. Gills, yeah. Are you coming out?
Possibly.
All right. We are making, I don't want to say where we're going, but we are making a pilgrimage to a very large Asian market center.
Well, you just gave it away, Eric.
There's a few of them. No, there's one of them. But we're going to go there and enjoy the food. We're going to go find Japanese toys. We're going to see their supermarkets and find all kinds of weird shit for the consumer and Zia's snack stream. We got to get her that dehydrated octopus that looks like beef jerky.
I've had something like that, like cuttlefish, like dehydrated cuttlefish before. Right. That's before, like, big in Hawaii. Yeah. People eat that a lot. And it's good. I don't mind it. It's a little fishy, but it's not bad.
Old Nerdy's asking if pilgrimage, is that why Zia looks like a pilgrim?
Actually, I saw.
You don't look ahead, like sorry. That. You look like one of those, German women that are bringing the big steins of beer.
The beer. Yeah. So I have, hold on.
Is Nick in a bear suit in the other room on fire? That is a question.
Yes, he is. And he's, okay. And he's this has is beer things fest. That he was bringing me in his butt.
I just didn't know if there was a midsummer thing happening here.
Is he going to bring you a stein from his butt? Because that we need
he's
to gonna say.
He's going to bring me a stein from his butt. Yeah. Right. We do need the video of Nick bringing me stuff in his butt. What are the chances of you bringing me that corset thing I have?
In your body.
I don't know where it is either. It might be in the closet. It's somewhere.
You know what?
Anyway, I got this for the Renaissance Fair, and someone got it for me off my Amazon wish list, and I'm so excited because I got this little corset, and I'm going to put a flower crown on, and I'm fucking dressing up for the Renaissance Fair. Yeah. So that's
I think it starts. Does it start this week or next week? You're talking about the New York State Renaissance Fair?
Yeah, the New York Renaissance Fair. This weekend it starts? Yeah, okay.
Do people like go to that show and up like dressed up like Michelangelo and Donatello and stuff like that?
No,
like,
they go dressed as pirates.
I don't think so.
Whoa, is that a wrestling belt?
Yeah. I'm the tag team champion of the world.
But she has no tag team partner. It's just her. She's with two belts.
It's just me.
Yeah.
That's why she's so good. Like, people lose to an invisible person.
Everything's
like,
a handicap match.
So I got this, and I'm going to wear this to the Ren Faire. It's my Ren Faire outfit. Fuck yeah. This is happening.
You're very excited about, apparently.
I'm so excited. I've always wanted to dress up for the Ren Faire. What did you say, Giddles? I'm sorry.
When's the Ren Faire?
It starts this weekend, I think, this coming weekend. It goes for like 2 months.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
I think Matt's going there. Matt OG is going
there. Yeah, he usually goes.
Yeah. He's really all about it.
A healer.
Almost to...
could be a pirate.
To a very insane level. Like, he goes, as you would say, to the nines. Dresses to the nines. He's got full outfits. He's got rapiers. He's got pirate stuff. He's got medieval stuff. He goes.
Well, you don't want to be the drummer at the wrong gig, guy. Like, you can't show up in like the wrong like outfit. You're gonna look stupid, Eric.
That's true.
If he was a Comic-Con cosplayer, like he showed up from that Critical Role character that he dresses in blue, and he just shows up for that with the big giant lollipop, walking into Ren Faire, and then somehow it works. Like, nobody questions it.
Yes, open to say Kylo Renaissance Fair. Now we're talking Kylo Ren Faire.
Booed himself afterwards. He was like, "I will. You don't have to boo me. I will do it myself." Kylo Renaissance Fair.
Yeah,
Zia. With that outfit, like, you could recreate that scene from National Lampoon's European Vacation, where Russ is in that. Russ is standing off to he's off at this little hideaway place with the German beer girl. And she's wearing that outfit, and she's about to. She just starts opening up her blouse and flashes him, and he kind of freaks out, like, because he's seeing boobs.
Well, what Zia can do is that. Oh, geez, wow!
I'm just joking. I was now recreating the scene.
I completely forgot what I was going
to
say.
Well, sorry, you can do it here because you won't probably be able to do it on OnlyFans much longer. But it's all right.
No, so they're still allowed, from what I've understood from OnlyFans, they're still allowing nude photos and videos. You can't do like penetration stuff anymore, which I didn't do anyway. So,
see, that's the outfit you got to recreate there.
Oh, there we go.
You got to get Nick to get that a denim jacket and that goofy hat. And then you can do National Lampoon European Vacation cosplay.
I like it.
What Zia needs to do is Zia needs to get a beer stein and a gyro and recreate every poster that's in every pizza place from the 80s in the city of like the gyro beer girl. That it's always like a hot girl with a gyro. And you're like, why is that? Like, this is how they're selling gyros. Like, this is the market. And it worked. I mean, I bought gyros my whole life, but like
sex sells, man. It really does. It's ridiculous, but it's true.
Now I'm looking for this poster. Where did you see
this? Hold on. I'll find it.
I see one of Maria Menounos holding a gyro, but that's not the one I'm thinking of.
I'll post it.
I've seen that too. I saw her in a freaking. Nick and I went to a Greek restaurant once in L. Or no, it wasn't L. A. It was outside of L. A. And Maria was on those fucking posters and menu things.
I'm sending it to you on Discord, Eric.
Well, just you can share it with us here.
Oh, how do I do this? This is a new technology.
Where the share thing is at the bottom there.
Oh, hold on a second here. Give me 1 second.
That would be awesome.
Chip is my tag team partner.
Chip is your what?
Chip is my tag team partner.
All right, let's do this.
Jer Basham said.
Okay.
Share screen?
I'll add it. Yeah, you got to pick the photo because it's just showing totally a bunch of different photos.
Oh, God damn it. Hold on. Share video file? What am I sharing? Eric, what is this?
Tell me what the... All right. Just tell me what the search is. I'll figure it out.
I just typed in gyro posters of the 80s and I found a whole thread on Twitter with like every picture of them.
That's gyro amazing.
Posters, 80s.
Yeah, and then just type it into images.
Oh, this girl.
Yeah.
Wait, that's the kid from Growing Pains.
Wait, which one?
No, hold on. I'll show you. This is the girl. This is the girl from Growing Pains. This is something else. I'm showing you this one here. So this is the one you're talking about, right?
Yeah, there's that one.
There's that one? Okay.
That's hilarious.
But then there's the other one.
This is making me want a gyro, though, for real. Now I want one.
Actually, you know what?
Oh, wait, one of these is Melania Trump.
Is it really?
Yeah, I had no idea.
I want this one. This one will be. Show you this.
Come on, Eric.
I'm sorry. It's just taking.
Yeah, it's not as easy as it looks because it says video file. Well, you're like, this isn't a video.
No, when you don't have a producer, I want this one. Look at that.
DiCaprio old nerdiness. Gotta get some for the ladies.
How is he holding those two like that? That is such a mess in your hand, like, and just covered in goo.
And the spigot that's holding the lamb is on what used to be the Twin Towers.
Oh my god. Oh, I didn't even see that because I was so confused by how he's holding these what look like gyro crocs in his hand. Like, oh my god.
Wow, that is some really bad photoshopping.
Or really genius photoshopping.
So that's a good point.
I'm looking for the
one. It's a fine line.
I can't find one where a girl's eating a gyro and holding a thing of beer.
I could be confusing just the beer steins with the gyro because they put them next to each other. So like, I could very well be like,
well, Zia, you know what you have to do now. Your next modeling shoot needs to be you holding a gyro and a stein of beer in that outfit.
I like this idea.
It is.
Yeah, I like this idea a lot. I need a push-up bra. My boobs look fucking fantastic like this. I love it so much. Okay, that was it. Look at that. Look at, I have cleavage. This is wonderful. This is what it feels like to have boobs. Everybody that's telling, everybody that's like, don't get a boob job. Your boobs are perfect the way they are. I'm not believing you anymore. Now that I'm looking at this cleavage, this is wonderful.
You need a segment on your site called Cleavage to Beaver. And it's just like, you know.
That'll get her banned right away.
Cleavage and Beaver.
It's the old sitcom, you know.
You leave it to Beaver.
That's the that's the kid from Growing
Pains. Why does he have gyros for little hands?
I don't know, but it's hilarious.
I would eat my hands.
I would too.
I'm delicious.
Oh, I'm so hungry. Yeah, somebody's now.
Like, stop eating your hands, but he goes, but I'm so delicious and tasty.
Oh God.
Go so back to Zia. Okay, sorry. We're going back to Zia. There you
Edward
go.
Edward Gyro Hands.
Oh. Edward Gyro Hands.
That could be a Channel 59 song. Gyro Hands. She wants to know why her hands, why they gotta be this way.
And then she ate them, and she had no hands. Gyro Hands.
Eating Gyro Hands.
What is wrong with
us? You definitely need to do that shoot until before OnlyFans gets rid of you. You got to go and you do the German girl outfit. You got to, especially if you're going up to the Renaissance Fair, I'm sure you could find some nice corsets and stuff up there. And do that.
Push up
the
booby
beer,
corsets.
We got to get you a beer stein. We got to get you many gyros because she'll be eating them before the shoot's even done.
Yeah, that's also true.
Right.
Yeah, a super hero shoot because it's technically pronounced hero, so you can be a new superhero.
Oh my god! And I could also do it
you
with
can be tzatziki
heroes.
Girl, and you just fucking throw handfuls of tzatziki in people's face, and then they're like, "It's so delicious!" And then you murder them.
I love that idea so much.
And then you turn
I want to do
gyros.
That. I want to do that skit so badly now. I want to do that where it's Gittles, you can be the adversary and I'll just throw tzatziki in your face and then stab you in the neck with a knife, but we'll do a fake knife obviously.
I like this idea.
Are you sure? I mean, if you want to, that's how we could do it. I like this skit idea a lot.
Did you ever know that you're my gyro?
Oh, that's a good question. Is George sleeping?
He is. He's right here. I threw a piece of cat food on him. It's just sitting on his stomach. Like, he has no idea.
Oh, boy.
Little Georgie.
Well, we can get to this before we got to take a break. Well, two things. One, Comic-Con is happening.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And it's going to be in person?
I don't know if I want to go to it, but we're all going to be registered for it.
We are going to be registered for it.
Yeah, we're putting in the registration for it, and then we'll decide as we get closer to it. Because, look, it's still maybe a month and a half away, and we don't know who's going to be involved. Like, if it's just going to be the floors open for shopping, I mean, we can do that, but it's not going to really do anything for the show because we get interviews and such from there in order to do the radio show from there. If we're going to just go to shop, I'll use my pass to get in, get what I want, and then get the fuck out because I don't want to be around that if we don't have to. But apparently it's still open. They're requiring vaccinations So you have to show your vaccination stuff to come in to do that. I know that's a big hot button issue for everybody now with everything having to require vaccinations. I'm still trying to figure out what to do because I'm not a resident of the state of New York, so I can't use that app that they're trying to say counts for everything.
I'll send you the link, Eric. I have a link that has like all the information you need if you're from out of state. I'll send that to you. I forgot to send it last night.
Because you and I were talking the other night. I kept Googling, like, well, yeah, a lot of people are from New York, but a lot of people in the city are from Connecticut and from New Jersey that come in there to work. So if we can't use the official state thing, like, how? I'm not bringing my fucking card with me every time because I don't want to lose it. And, you know, showing all your stuff just in order to go into Starbucks to buy something.
I'll say this. I've been into the last 3 days since the ban came into effect. I have not had to show my vax card once. Well, even at places that have the sign on the door, have not asked. So, like, I don't know if it's being as enforced as they say it is.
That's what I'm trying to figure out, because on paper or on the books, if you will, it is. Like, that's going to be the guideline from and doubled up because of the city. So de Blasio's all saying we're enforcing this, and then the state has the thing that they're saying they're enforcing this. But here's the situation. Outside of whether you feel your rights are being violated or whatever, how are they going to enforce this? Because this is just the government telling people to self-police, and that never works, because you'll get people that were, like, during the quarantine, you have assholes that were snitching on their neighbor because they had family over and calling the cops, and like, people are pieces of shit. But on this giant scale like this, you're not going to get every business carding people, because some of these businesses don't have enough people to run their business. I mean, these restaurants, they're understaffed. So if it's like a family thing and you've got a husband and wife running a pizzeria, you know, and the family thing, they don't have a maitre d', they don't have a host, they don't have this stuff to sit there and card and check everybody to come in to buy stuff.
I also think after this year and everything that happened, a lot of those places aren't going to want to turn away business.
Right.
For people that aren't. It's like, it's one of those things. Thank you. Someone's OP Broadcasting School. Hell yeah. That's not a compliment. Thank you. it's one of those things where they're not going to want to turn away business. So if they're going to have, they need every customer they get. And if they don't have people working, I feel like that's one of those things they're not necessarily going to look into that much.
Because they've been flashing it. Zia, you're in the area, so you see all the New York City news and stuff from ABC, CBS, all that stuff. They're constantly flashing that screen about, here's where, you know, you can't go into gyms, you can't go into entertainment venues, you can't go into restaurants, you can't go, like, there's a whole list of things that you can't do unless you're vaccinated and showing proof. Now, outside of, like, say, going to the Yankees game or going to a concert at the Garden or something where they have the staff to enforce that, everything else, like, gyms don't have enough people to enforce that stuff. Restaurants definitely don't. So the majority of the stuff on that list may want to comply, or maybe they don't, but they don't have the personnel to even comply if they wanted to. So I'm thinking, is it just going to be a matter of time before they either have to rethink this whole thing or say, like, all right, we're not requiring this anymore because they just can't enforce it?
Well, here's the issue. And the issue is that in March, this whole plan was in place. Everybody I knew downloaded the app. We all had our shit. We were ready to go. And then, like, they were just like, oh, yeah, the CDC just said we're all giving up, so we don't have to worry about masks anymore. And everyone just threw their hands up and said it's over. And now you can't put that genie back in the bottle. You know what I mean? Like, if we were doing this since then when we were supposed to, like, that, it wouldn't be a problem.
Right.
But, like, I don't know. It's just, it doesn't make sense to me to just, like, to just be so against it. Like, that's what's really annoying to me, is the people just being like, I shouldn't have to, like, prove that I'm vaccinated. It's like, yeah, but, like, if I'm running a business, if you come in and get one of my employees sick, now I can't run my business. Like, the same thing you're saying, like, oh, we can't have people who are like, you know, checking everything at the door, but I also can't have employees who are sick who are calling in because they got COVID because someone didn't wear a mask.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, like, it goes both ways. And if I had a business and someone fucking died because I didn't enforce it and then someone came in with COVID, I would feel horrible. if I lost an employee to something really stupid because some person got fucking misinformation from Fox News. So I don't know. I don't see the big deal. I don't see how it's in any kind of way discrimination against people. Like, if you don't want to get the shot, you're discriminating against yourself at this point. So, like, I don't know. I'm very pro-vaccine. I don't see an issue with it. Our good friend Dr. Steve has done the trials. He has signed up. He's gotten the shot.
He was one of the first in the nation.
That's what I'm saying. Like, he was one of the first people to nation to get it. And, like, you know, I trust him. And, like, you know, we don't believe in, like, a lot of the same politics, but I agree with him on this because he knows what he's talking about with that. So, like, it's just, it doesn't make sense. I don't know. My sister is fully vaccinated. She caught Delta and she was pretty sick for a couple of days, you know? So, like, you can still catch it. You can still spread it. Just be careful out there. I just don't understand.
Open to say, imagine being a security guard turning away some kids all dressed up like anime characters. I'd be like, just go ahead. Yeah, that's probably what it's going to be. Well, see, Comic-Con is one of those places that has the staff to enforce that.
Yeah, they'll check. They'll enforce it.
But you're talking the smaller places, gyms, restaurants, coffee shops, little boutiques, things like that that involve food. They're not going to be able to do that. So I don't know. It just somebody said it earlier. I think I saw that's like this is never going to end. I try to be optimistic, but it feels that way because everyone is just on both sides.
Because it got very politicized, Eric. Like it's a virus. Like this is something that should not have politics. Like, you know what I mean? If we're going down the whole timeline of this thing, it went from no one's going to get sick with it, the sun and things are going to kill it, I created the vaccine, don't trust it. Like, it's just there's so much of circular logic that's gone on in the past year that, like, it should have never been this way.
Right.
And I don't know. Is it – so
– wait.
Rock's message?
Rock
is it
lives
hurricane?
In Brooklyn, right?
Yeah.
Right. Rock just got an email from Spectrum, which is used to be Time Warner Cable. Now it's Spectrum. That my service might be disrupted because of Hurricane Henri or Henry or however.
That's what I was just going to ask. Is it Henri or is it Henry?
I think it's Henri. So your cape. Look, you're in Brooklyn. It's not even supposed to hit you, though. Like the whole center of the storms, the east end of Long Island going up through, you know, Cape Cod and all of that. And they're saying, well, you know, you're 150 miles away. Your cable still may go out because of of the wind blowing. It's like, why do we pay for
also,
anything?
Also, let's just put it this way. Spectrum like that would just go out for me without a warning. So, like, I haven't had that issue since I switched
to Fios.
So I would say, Rock, if you have a chance to switch to Fios before Sunday, definitely do it.
Did a lot of just live your life or don't live your life. Fucking whatever I want to die when I think of this stuff. Yep, I'm with you.
It sucks.
If we want to turn to some better news, a message from Blue Healer to Zia. Zia, you owe me a follow or a headstand.
I don't remember ever agreeing to that. He just made a deal with himself and was like, okay. And I was like, what?
I don't know, Zia. You got to be a woman.
Never agreed
to this. You got to be a woman of your word there. If you promised, you either got to follow or
I didn't, though. That's the thing. He just said it. He's like, either do me a headstand, do a headstand or follow me. And I was like, I did not agree to this at any point.
Why would he lie? Why would he lie?
Healer said $10 was involved. Ask Nick. But I do remember you bringing it up, but I never agreed to any of what was happening. I never agreed to anything. And because I know I can't do a headstand. If it was a deal, it would be different, but I also know I can't do a headstand. So.
All right. Oh, well, guess you're shit out of luck there, Blue Healer. I'm sorry.
What if Zia just shows up in Kentucky and like literally does a headstand and just follows him like physically
follows him
down the sidewalk. He's like, I'm here to follow
it's
you.
It's the new crab walk from The Exorcist. She's just on her headstand and she's walking like that. And you're like, this girl's coming out of a cornfield chasing you across the street
with a beer stein and a gyro somehow. Like, run.
Apparently,
I'm grabbing her from my basement. Healer. As long as you feed me snacks.
his only plans for the tornado.
I think Cremo was implied.
Jordan's in the chat. Come pirate with us. Yes, Zia, you said you would come pirate with us one night.
Yeah, I just need a night that I can actually do it.
All right. Well, you figure out a time and we'll schedule everything accordingly so that we can go and do that.
Yeah, Dinotic said he wants to play, but the hurricane might get in his way. No.
In the game or in real life?
They need more hurricanes in the game. We were talking about this the other day. There needs to be more water spouts and more like other things than storms, but that's a longer story.
Real quick inside with the game. So there was a lot of respawning issues with all these new creatures they put in. Like they didn't stop. You'd kill a whole wave of them.
It was insane.
Try to do something and they'd show up again. They fixed all that. Somebody now was complaining saying, there's too many storms. Get rid of the storms or just make them very rare. Everyone else is like, you don't know how to play the game then. The storms can really help you out with some certain things. And I like what Gittles is saying. If you're out there in the ocean, out of nowhere, just a water spout appears and your boat goes flying like Zelda Wind Waker when the tornado would grab you and throw you a different side of the map and just fuck up your plans, I'd be all about that.
Huh. So it says last night that around 2:30 a tornado did touch down in Pennsylvania. So you were pretty close.
Shit.
This is just breaking news right now. It said New Jersey had a tornado that actually touched down on Sunday that was categorized as an F0, which means it only had 65 to 85 mile per hour winds at Rockaway, New Jersey.
At Rockaway?
Yeah, Rockaway, New Jersey.
That just meant a bag was circling around in a parking lot like fucking American Beauty, you know, where the guy.
Oh, I hate that bag.
Yeah, F-Zeros are boring. Correct, Healer. They are. All right, let's take a break. When we come back, Zia, I got an update for you about Toys R Us, and I want to talk to you about. Gittles has something on the show The OA that was canceled on Netflix with their fan base. I want to tell you a little bit about this show called F-Boy Island, and the new Eternals trailer came out. So cool. I'm going to ask you about that. So we're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
More, it's Eric Nagel.
It's Eric Nagel.
Next.
The Boys from Brooklyn! Brooklyn! The Boys from Brooklyn!
Hey, it's David Brody.
And I'm Skeery Jones from the nationally syndicated Elvis Duran in the Morning Show.
After you're done listening to this episode of It's Eric Nagel, we invite you to check out our The Brooklyn Boys podcast with Brody and Skeery.
Skeery and Brody.
Our podcast is a lot like Eric's podcast, except it's nothing like Eric's podcast. We love Eric. We've been friends with him a long time, but we do our own thing.
We argue and debate with each other, and sometimes Brody just argues with himself.
No, I don't. Yes, I do.
See what I mean?
The Brooklyn Boys podcast. It's two guys from Brooklyn, but we don't talk about Brooklyn. We talk about everyday life and the things that bother us that probably bother you as well.
Sometimes we expose scambonis. We learn even is not even, and we get free dessert because of that.
And I'll explain exactly what that means, and you'll thank me later.
So subscribe to us for free. The Brooklyn Boys podcast, and make sure you listen in order from episode zero. Available on the iHeartRadio app
and all those other apps that have podcasts. All right, now back to more Eric and his friends.
No, I'd rather hear us talk.
And truthfully, so would Eric.
The Boys from Brooklyn!
It's Eric Nagel. Follow the show on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, YouTube, and Facebook at It's Eric Nagel.
Okay, let's get down to it, boppers.
And we're back here for segment two of the program. The Ron and Fez show. I'm Ron. There's Fez.
Everyone's muted.
You're out there.
There we go. I'm just like.
Are we all just? Just shoving food in our mouths. We're like, all right,
Yep.
It's late. I get it.
Marley, exactly what's happening.
What food are you shoving in your mouth, Zia? I'm shoving fries in my mouth.
Tzatziki Triscuits, which are actually pretty fucking good. They legitimately taste like tzatziki. The only thing that would be better if I had tzatziki to dip it in.
See, that's your weapon. You use tzatziki Triscuits, like throwing stars at people, and you just whip them at them, and then they're like, I have a gluten allergy, and then they die.
Or they eat one and it gets stuck in their throat.
Yeah.
And they choke to death. Yeah.
100%. Where are
you? Because they're dry. I'm like, do we have any water? No water for you.
What are you doing?
They're so dry. I do like it, though.
I realized in segment one of the program we had other...
What kind of fries is that you're eating with a fork? I'm sorry, I just...
Overcooked French fries that I forgot in the oven while we did segment one. So I have to use a fork because I can't stab them because they're too hard.
Okay, I like it.
I realized in segment one because we had...
I can't hear you, Eric.
More important... What do you mean you can't hear me? Can you not hear me this whole time?
There you go.
No, I haven't. Damn it. I've been saying it. I wasn't joking. Even people in the chat. No audio from Eric.
The radio part can hear us, but the Twitch feed can't hear me. Okay. Well, I guess it's working now.
And your co-host, yes.
I guess it's working now. I was saying in the in segment one of the show, we got into a rather heavy topic that we didn't get to promote any of our stuff, so might as well just do it now. Don't call. Who gives a fuck? We don't need to give out the phone number. But you can follow us on It's Eric Nagel across the board on all the social medias. Like us on Facebook and YouTube. That was the other thing. I couldn't think of where it was. If you're listening on the radio and you're missing the live feed, you can get the full show minus commercials and bonus time and all that stuff. But you get the full show video-wise up on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/It's Eric Nagel. And that along with twitch.tv/It's Eric Nagel, you can watch us live Thursday, 7 p.m. when we do the program. So come join us there. Segment two is usually where we do a lot of our TV and movie stuff.
Two
indeed. Before we get to the box office, though, there was something I wanted to
tell you. With an old tip, old throwback there in the chat.
What is that one there? 19 years ago, August 15th, Sex for 16, Sam. Sex for Sam, and the last Opie and Anthony show on WNED. Yes, that's right. Because that I think one. The 21st or the 22nd is when we were officially canceled Done. By Infinity Broadcasting. So, yeah, the 16th. Wow. Next year will be the 20th anniversary. This is 19 years. This past week. So next year will be the 20th anniversary of Sex for Sam 3 that got the show canceled from nationwide syndication and WNEW in New York City.
You need to make like a commemorative pin of like the cathedral with someone like banging on it. Like, you know, that's like the rage this year. Like, you know.
You'll just see the confession booth.
Oh my God, old nerdy, your kid would be 20. You're right. That's terrifying.
Then you get a confession booth where the curtains only so goes down so far. You see legs sticking out from it.
Yeah.
It just says, "We fucked up, Opie and Anthony."
Yeah.
Okay. I'll have to talk to Anthony. Maybe we can figure out something like that and do that. I'm sure everybody else would be into doing that. No, but I wanted to tell you about this. So some good news. Toys R Us is coming back yet again. And it's not like doing the pop-up stores that they did a couple years ago where they just took over like old KBs or vacant stores in malls. So Toys R Us is doing signed a new deal with Macy's. So they're going to be partnering to sell their toys on the Macy's website. But they're also going to be opening up a store within a store in 400 department store locations for Macy's starting next year. So you can go into a Macy's and then go off to the side and then there's Toys R Us as it's now part of Macy's, which is brilliant because Macy's was like every other department store struggling and, you know, they lasted longer than Sears and JCPenney's did, but.
And Lord & Taylor that just closed.
Oh, they just, I never shopped. Wait, who did I know? Steve C. Steve C. used to shop at Lord & Taylor because when he was up in the Massachusetts area, Boston, going to school, he had a band called Foundry, which we've played their music, Foundry music and what have you. He would get these leopard skin blouses and stuff from Lord & Taylor and wear those on stage. It's fucking
That's
ridiculous.
Hilarious.
Yeah. God bless Steve.
Yeah, I've
Z,
never...
But,
oh, R.I.P. Yeah,
he's the only one outside of women that I knew shopped at Lord & Taylor. But they're closed down now?
Like, they're closed down now. I've never... Yeah, they're closed down for good. All of them. I've never been... They're like out of business. I've never been to a Lord & Taylor before ever until moving here. They don't exist, at least... not definitely not in Hawaii, and I never saw one on the West Coast. So I don't know. Maybe they're just... You know, not easy to find, but
did Lotta, anyway. You're right. It's Lane Bryant, not Lord & Taylor. I screwed up on that. That's my bad. But yes, Steve shopped at Lane Bryant.
Oh,
never
man.
Been to Lane Bryant.
For the women's
never
things,
been.
Not Lord & Taylor. My bad.
That makes sense because I think like wasn't Lane Bryant like they had more like plus size-y stuff that like for Steve.
Steve
yeah.
used to be a big boy.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so they're going out. Lord & Taylor's going away, but it makes
Lord & Taylor have flame themed blouses. Well, if they did, we know where Guy Fieri got all of his shit.
Flavortown.
So Toys R Us is now going to be part of Macy's. So you can go into Macy's department stores and go toy shopping again. And I was talking about this a couple weeks ago about having a kid now where I was thinking, I was like, no, there's so many things that I would love to share this experience with her, but they just don't exist anymore. You know, and we've always talked about, you know, video rental places and music stores and things like that. But the toy store you'd think would always be around because kids always want toys. And the main toy store Toys R Us went away a few years ago. They closed up shop. You don't have KB anymore. You don't have Child World. You don't have, I don't know any other toy stores that are not the...
Was Babbage's Electronics or was that a toy store?
They were like a Sam Goody, but electronics. Like, they sold computer games and then had other weird shit like a Sam Goody or a Suncoast Video would, right? They also had that neon lighting so you could see. I was like, is it Spencer's? No, it's Babbage's. Okay, Now I know. I was thinking about that experience, like, man, being a kid where you could go run into the toy store and just see everything on the shelves and actually touch things and look at them. And Target and Walmart are doing a horrible job of trying to keep that up because their toy departments rarely have anything. Now, I know there's shipping issues because of the pandemic, but even before all that, they were terrible at keeping anything in stock. They never had anything new. It was always just like a million of something that a kid didn't want, all in all the pegs. So with Toys R Us coming back, and hopefully this works because Macy's is a a powerhouse company to fund all of this. It sounds dumb, but it's an experience I'm glad she may get to have again. You know, when she's a little bit older, to go walking through a toy store and just let her go down the aisles and figure out what she likes, see how her personality develops, to see what she's into, what she wants to play with.
Yeah, like walk down the aisle, find a toy.
I feel like there are some things like Blockbuster, video stores like that, that we have feelings for because it's feelings of nostalgia. But in reality, they don't necessarily need to. There's not a real reason for those to exist. Like if they came back now, it'd be stupid. But I feel like with toy stores, that is an experience. There is a reason for those to be there. It's because, you can look online and get stuff, but it's not the same as going and being surrounded by that energy and being able to physically pick up toys and press the buttons and try them out and see which ones you like. I feel like that's
still
something.
I still go to toy stores.
Yeah, so do I. I love it. Nick and I will, whenever we go to Target, we almost always end up walking down the toy aisles and being like, look at this.
We're going Saturday. So that fun. Japanese import store has a whole toy store there. We're going to go and look through everything.
Yeah, and you're like, I want to buy all these Nerf guns.
Yes. Oh my God. Have you seen the Nerf guns these days?
They're insane.
So much cooler than when we were kids.
I've learned
there's
so much.
There's one that has like a 500 barrel thing and it's got like a hand crank on it. Like it's World War II. You're like, what is this shit?
I just saw that one.
How many children can I repel with this? That's what I saw.
I've learned so much about the Nerf guns because of Matt OG's son.
Love Nerf guns.
He just collects them. He loves the Nerf stuff, but he has, like, Fortnite has their own kind of guns that are tied in with Nerf. So you have that. Then you have, like, the military style one. He has this one that looks like a Vulcan cannon where you just put it down and you just put, like, 40 different or 30 or 40 different of these little arrow things there, and you hold the thing and it's just spinning the ammunition and it's just nonstop. I would love to see the Afghan war being fought with Nerf weapons. Probably.
Well, have you ever seen the guy? Well, have you ever seen the guy on YouTube who like redoes them to see how far he could shoot like Nerf projectiles, and like he like makes them so that like they shoot pretty far. Like it's pretty crazy.
No, I would love to see that though. Send me links later.
I'll find the link to it. Yeah.
But I'm kind of glad seeing this because not only the toy experience for a kid to go into a toy store, because we've all had that. Our parents had that. You know, there was always some sort of, what did they call them? Five and Dimes, Woolworths, stores like that.
I remember Woolworths.
Right?
When I was really little.
Oh, yeah. I remember Woolworths. I remember it just as I think they were closing out because the South Shore Mall where Gittles and I grew up had a Woolworths there. It was one of the big entrances to the mall. You'd come through Woolworths. It was the big store, but they also had in one corner, they had the dining counter where you can go and you could sit on essentially it looked like a 1950s kind of diner where you would sit on the stools. You could get milkshakes and grilled cheese and all this other shit there before food got really good with food courts and all that, but it was all right in there. And they used to have the toy section. They were great for Christmas stuff. And then you'd go down to Sears if you were doing Christmas. You get the wish book and you go through the wish book to look through everything.
I wish my parents wouldn't buy me shit from Sears.
Yes.
I hated Sears even when I was a kid, too. Sears has always sucked.
Craftsman tools as a kid, this is great.
But here's the thing. You didn't get your stuff from Sears. You had the Sears wish book to see all the new toys and stuff because they had full layouts and displays of how you can use the toys and scenarios and settings, and you would circle everything and you'd make a list so that your parents could go to Toys R Us and other places and get it instead of going to Sears. Sears wish book was just to show you what was available because you didn't have online obviously then, and you didn't see everything. If there was not enough commercials during kids shows on TV. You didn't know these things existed, but you got the Wish book. You're flipping through everything. Like, oh my God, I didn't know that existed. You circle that. Yeah. You want that. And then they go to Toys R Us and pick it up, or Child World, or whatever else is still open at that time.
Child World.
Right. That just, that sounds like another version of the internet. That's just an old version of the internet where you go and you wish list stuff and then you go pick up in, you're like, oh, pick up in store. This is available right. And then you go pay. That's exactly what that is.
It was called Layaway, and you'd order it and then pay it over time and then pick it up.
Damn it, Gittles. I was just going to say that. I was about to say, like, they would show you how to do layaway on every bottom of the page.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, Cowbot. Cowbot says, my dad's family was so poor they used Sears and Roebuck catalog as toilet paper in their outhouse. True story. Wow.
Oh, man. I thought those catalogs sucked, but I wouldn't want to wipe my ass with one.
They were glossy finishes. They weren't like matted, you know, printouts. So that's,
well,
that's
I will
some
say,
high quality toilet paper there.
We weren't like poor at all, but this was back before my dad was making too much money. But my dad is just one of those dads that was like not together. This wasn't too long after my mom died, and he used to forget to buy toilet paper all the time. So we would have to use newspaper to wipe, and that sucked because it stains. Like that stuff rubs off. The ink and all comes off.
If you handle newspapers for like 5 minutes, your hands are black. Like it's gross.
It's horrible. So we used to have to use newspaper toilet paper kind of a lot for a lot. I remember telling
out, crinkle it up to soften it and use it. Ooh,
there you go. Yeah.
What does Nick use? Because he just shoves everything up there. So
he
like,
just puts everything in his butt. Yeah,
just everything.
He's got a hose attachment that screws right onto there. Every day is just a full colonic.
Just shaking his
He's
head.
Like a butt kangaroo. Like he just stores things back there.
Walks around the same way. Ever. He's hopping. Because his insides are all damaged.
He's keeping things in his butt. He's got to keep them in there.
It's a marsupial.
You know what? Nick's backside looks like Mr. Potato Head. You hit the thing and all the pieces fall right out. And you're like, how does he live? Where are his innards? It's just trunk storage.
He's got to wear the Elmer Fudd pajamas to keep shit in his butt.
We get stopped every time that we fly. They always think it's drugs, but he's like, no, I'm just storing snacks up there. Don't worry about
it. Sorry, that's my ticket. He's smuggling. That's my pre-boarding pass. Yeah.
He's smuggling uranium outside of the country.
Yeah. Uranium.
Bluestrel says, poor Nick didn't ask for any of this. I like looking over and seeing his reactions. I don't think he's listening right now, but he usually just looks over and then he just shakes.
Rock's saying, I want a butt kangaroo now.
Hey, anything can happen.
I want a butt kangaroo, too.
The butt kangaroo?
Official mascot of IM. I like that a lot.
Any artists out there, if you want to draw a butt kangaroo for us?
I'd really enjoy that.
We definitely could use that. We could make a poster or something.
That's so funny.
Yeah, just put that on Twitter. Can anyone commission me a butt kangaroo? Time's a factor.
Hold on. I'm going to tweet that right now. Gittles, this is happening.
Well, Toys R Us is coming back. I'm excited. We'll see
what
they're
doing.
It's
a giraffe, not a kangaroo.
I know.
You bet. Imagine, giraffe it is.
I don't want to grow up. I'm a Toys R Us kid. We can see the butt kangaroo hanging out the door. And then Spider-Man will be there Saturday to say hi to the kids. And the good old days. That'd be great, too, if they did that with the new Toys R Us. Remember, because you used to see the full produced national Toys R Us spots, but then they'd have the local versions where it would cut the theme in half. Mm-hmm. And then it would say, come down to, you know, the Toys R Us in Bayshore, right next to the South Shore Mall, and see Spider-Man and all his friends. And it's just, it's the equivalent of the people that were in Times Square with those shitty costumes. So you're supposed to go there and, like, get balloons and take a photo with a guy in a Spider-Man pajama set.
Yeah, and like the local news stations that had to like edit those like national commercials to throw that always did a terrible job because it would always be like a record scratch when like the new voiceover would come and be like, oh yeah, and this week at the Bayshore, Toys R Us, we got Spider-Man, Batman.
They'd always have the
all
fonts.
Your favorites.
They'd have the fonts on it that made the noise. Like you'd be hearing anything, all of a sudden they show the like the bright white graphics for whatever the text is, and it's making noise as you're listening to it. Like, this was poorly thought out. But anyway, so while Z is tweeting out about butt kangaroos, let's go over and look at the box office here from the past week. Coming in number one was Free Guy, the Ryan Reynolds movie. He's doing well. Apparently, they signed for a second one.
I watched it.
Was it good? Did you like it?
You know what? I really enjoyed it. It was funny. I was laughing out loud definitely a few times. It was enough. And it was just overall fun. It was just one of those movies where you go watch and you have a good time and you laugh and you leave the theater feeling good. There were some moments in there that I really enjoyed too. Without spoiling anything, they got to use some properties that were very fun and very well placed.
Yeah, I had read a review that was like, what if Ready Player One was a fun movie and people enjoyed it? They're like, watch Free Guy. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
So is it worth going to the theater to see it, or should you wait to just get it on demand when it comes on?
I think it's one of those that's good to see in theater. I really do. I think that I enjoyed it in theater, and I think that having it be on the big screen with some of the stuff they did is better.
Okay. Then maybe I'll go and venture out and take a look at it this weekend. That might be something to do. Number two coming in, Don't Breathe 2, which is the Stephen Lang movie. Number three, Jungle Cruise. Number four, Respect.
R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
That Aretha Franklin movie doesn't look like
found
it's made
out what
well.
It means to me. No, it doesn't.
I saw that trailer. I was like, I don't think I want to, like, even if this was made-for-TV thing, like it just showed up on ABC on a Sunday, I was like, I don't know if I want to watch this. It doesn't look like a good biopic. It just seems kind of ham-handed.
I'm just over biopics.
Same. Every time a new one comes out, I'm just like, all right. I didn't watch Rocket Man. I didn't watch, like, any of those. And
I'd watch it if it was a documentary. Like, I would totally watch it if it was a documentary.
That's
but
different.
Like,
yeah,
it's just like these people are telling the story, and like, I just don't care that much.
It's always acted by some famous person, and you're like, okay, I don't believe you're Aretha Franklin because I know who you are.
I mean, every time they do these biopic movie type things, it's always somebody who's. Yeah, but it's always somebody who's clearly trying to win an Oscar. You know what I mean? And I don't there's always movies that come out every year and you're like, oh, this is a movie that someone's trying to win an Oscar, which is clearly not something for me, if you know my movie choices.
Yeah, it's a formula set just to impress the Academy.
Yeah, and like, I see
what
that.
People think about it.
Yeah, and I see that. I'm just like, Rock, did anyone watch The Green Knight last night? No, and I really wanted to, and I'm so angry that I missed it.
It was only for one day, right?
It was only for like one day, yeah.
So when are we going to actually get to watch it? Watch it. What's the deal with that?
Like, is
it? Well, it's in theaters, so you can go.
Okay, all right. So it was streaming for one day.
Who gets to play it? It's our. Well, I don't know.
That's a question for another time. Bring that up next week when we have a little bit more time. We'll definitely talk about that because I need to think about.
Yeah, I would need to think about that too.
I could see Kristen Bell doing Aziah. They're about the same height.
Kristen Bell.
And she could be very high energy. She's already got the blonde hair.
Okay, so I got Brett Gilman for me, obviously. People asked me on the street if I am him already.
Right.
Let's see. Who can we get? Eric?
I don't know, but we'll answer that next week. What else do we have movie-wise? We talked about Comic-Con. We have that. The new Eternals trailer came out. Marvel's Eternal trailer, and they answer the question in the trailer, which I don't care about the answer either, because I think it's not good. But this was all something that didn't need to be in the trailer. Like, if you would have just left the question, well, why didn't you interfere when Thanos snapped? And they just left that in the trailer like that, then you're like, oh, they're going to answer it. I'm going to see it in the movie. And they give you the fucking answer in the trailer.
I always do that. I didn't watch it.
You're probably... Are you going to go see it?
Yeah, of course, yeah. I'll go watch all those movies, but I just...
I'll tell you something. Don't bother with seeing the trailer. Here's some things that I can tell you that's not going to ruin anything. You see Celestials in there. A Celestial shows up, and it's not the one that... I was talking with Jordan the other night. I thought it was the one that we saw in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, was it, I think? Where you saw the guy holding the... I can't remember the fucking names now. Jordan, if you're in here...
Eleanor?
I need your...
Thor's hammer?
Not Thor's hammer. He was holding something else.
Thor's pencil? Captain America's shield.
No. This is... I don't want to look this up.
The Tesseract?
You're just naming inanimate objects. I'm trying to name the fucking essentials. The Essentials.
The Celestials.
Yeah, that's our movie.
$15 an hour, wear a mask.
That's our Marvel
The Celestials
movie,
are the ones that created the Eternals, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so that makes sense that they'd
so
be in the movie.
So in the movie, you... All right, you see these two. So in the movie, you see... Oh, you fucking kidding me. I had the names and I lost it. All right, this is going nowhere. Fuck it. Watch the movie or don't. What do I care? Doesn't matter.
Some more steals.
So what did they spoil? Why didn't they interrupt? Can you spoil it for
me?
Do
you want
me
to spoil it for you?
I'm not going
to
watch it. So yeah, please.
Yeah, do it. I don't care.
There's these certain, like how the Eternals were created. There's the bad version of them. The
Decepticons.
Let's go with that because I can't remember the name. And they said unless those particular creatures are involved, the rules are they're not allowed to interfere with the development of mankind in this planet and what have you. And there's already debate that Thanos was part of this particular group the way he was created, that he would count as one of these things where they should have interfered. Maybe that's a plot line. I don't know. But they said Thanos was supposed to do what he's supposed to do, and it wasn't part of these other creatures, so that they couldn't get involved, even though half the universe got wiped out. But the new trailer just starts with Salma Hayek, whatever her character's name is, just saying how amazing this planet is and has to be protected at all costs. And goes, these people, when Thanos snapped his finger, half the population disappeared, not just from this planet, but from the universe. He goes, but the people, this one single planet, with the snap of a finger, brought everything back. And they're just saying, like, there's something else that's going on here. But because Tony Stark did that snap, reset the universe, got everybody back, it opened up another thing that we're exploring now, which is where the Eternals come into play, because the snap has something else come to Earth, and it's supposed to be pretty much Armageddon, like the elimination of the planet and of parts of the universe and what have you, and that's where this takes place. And I see it ties into, I think, to the multiverse as well. But this big celestial shows up with like six eyes and a mask and everything, and this it's one of those celestials that cast judgment, that go from planet to planet to determine if they're worthy or not for existing. So he shows up on Earth, and now I guess he's deeming the planet not worthy, and that's what they're fighting. So
all right,
yeah, it's a whole long to do of just all right, space robots are showing up and angels, so that's what we're fighting here. Angels versus space robots, and then somehow Doctor Strange gets worked in, and maybe Spider-Man swings by.
I mean, that's essentially just sounds like something, yeah.
So, well, that's coming.
Question:
I'm gonna watch it.
How long after the snap does everyone come back? Is it like instant?
Five years? Oh wait, no. The first snap, they disappear, and that happened for 5 years until the second snap. The second snap seemed to have happened instantly because the second snap was with the Hulk, when he brought everybody back. The third snap...
But what I mean is, like, when the second snap happened, did it go back the 5 years to where the first snap didn't happen?
It was current time. It was current time that this was all happening.
Oh, man, that would be so awkward if you had, like, a job, and then you come back after the snap for 5 years.
Right.
So people are like, where have you been?
It brings everybody back, but in current time. And then the third snap is when Tony Stark did it and got rid of Thanos and all his minions and everything. Yeah, the stream went out for a second. It's back. It looks like it's back.
Oh, very strange. Huh.
Yeah.
So. We got replies for Butt Kangaroo. I'm sorry. You continue. I'm just
looking at it. Let's hear about the replies for Butt Kangaroo.
Someone says,
I'm
afraid to ask, but what is a Butt Kangaroo? And I said, I'm picturing a kangaroo with a butt that he stores stuff in.
Tell him it's like Mr. Potato Head, but the pouch is on the back.
It's a marpoopial.
Yes, there you go. It's a marpoopial. That makes all the sense in the world.
Well, because he's not a marsupial.
Yes.
It's a marpoopial. Todd Ferguson says he's available.
All right. See if you can get it done.
And then, oh my God, someone also said it's a marpoopial. Oh, that was Gittles.
The call is coming from inside the tweet.
Plagiarizing yourself, Gittles.
God damn it. That guy always gets me.
Some other Marvel news, Zia, for you. So the rumor going around now is that Disney is pretty close to working a deal with Sony to make Spider-Man a permanent part of the MCU. and that they're looking to purchase the entire Spider-Man property rights from Sony.
Really?
Yeah.
You think Sony's going to sell?
I think they will. I think Disney's going to have to give up something. Maybe there's some Fox properties that they have or something that they have that they can do like a cash and trade at the same time, or future earning potential for whatever. Like maybe Sony still gets a percentage of the box office and merch sales or whatever for Spider-Man stuff, but they don't have any ownership or creative control over the Spider-Man properties anymore. So it's like everything's coming together nicely. It's like the evil plan is coming together. Disney's getting all of their shit back, and then it's full steam ahead. Like, they bought Marvel 12 years ago, I think. Yeah, around 12 years ago, for $4 billion. And those movies alone have grossed over, I think, $28 billion. So they've
worth the initial investment.
They more than paid that off. And that's just the Marvel movies. They also bought the Star Wars franchise for $4 billion. And all of those movies paid that back. From merch, TV, everything, all of that stuff. Everything was paid back. So there's just no stopping them. They're just going to have all the money and all the entertainment in the world.
But if they can Disney's keep putting out everything,
if they can keep putting out quality content, it's just a matter of time. I said this months ago. Disney will eventually get DC. They'll figure out a way, because Warner Brothers is just hemorrhaging everything with their DC properties. Some stuff works, but a lot of it doesn't. More of it doesn't work than does. So they're not getting the money back that they thought they were going to get from all these new ideas, new director's cuts, new everything. It's just not working for them. So if they could make that deal with Disney, and Disney sits on it for a little bit, just give it like a year or two with nothing coming out. Let it just kind of clear the playing field, and then all of a sudden you reboot Batman. You reboot Superman, Wonder Woman, all of that stuff in the right way where it all ties together like Marvel does. It'll be huge. It'll be huge. But we'll see what that
happens. It'll be Marvel.
DC, DC Comics. It's Marvel-ish.
You know, it's gonna be funny. They're gonna like Marvel's gonna be like, or they'll be like, "Yeah, we took DC," and you're like, "Cool." The comics, like, no, the town, like, we run this place now. You're like, "Oh fuck!"
Yeah.
President Thor.
We run the world.
Yeah.
Open to say saying Wolverine already. Here's the thing too with Wolverine. They're gonna get to the X-Men. They already said they're bringing the X-Men in, but not after. Not before they bring in Fantastic Four, which is still about a year or two away from Fantastic Four. Ryan Reynolds has been constantly tweeting about Hugh Jackman being involved with Deadpool 3, where Hugh Jackman says, "I'm not returning to that character." That's all bullshit. That's all wrestling kind of promo stuff. You've seen how those two have interacted in the past. They've done videos together for their own private companies. They've done things making fun of each other as Deadpool and Wolverine. Hugh can say whatever he wants, but if they throw enough money in just for him to do a cameo or something in Deadpool 3, it'll happen.
Do it.
He'll be there. You'll give everybody what they want, because they all want to see Hugh Jackman as Wolverine. Even if he's the alt timeline and then they pull Deadpool out of there into the new MCU thing, that's like another... like, Logan was a perfect goodbye for him, but this could be another kind of goodbye where if Deadpool leaves that universe, comes into this one, and Hugh Jackman's still there, and then you have the new Wolverine, you have all the new stuff, would be fun. They'll figure out ways to do it all, but I can see Hugh Jackman coming back at some point to doing this again, just to give the people, because he's so beloved as this character more than anything else that he's ever done. And he's a fantastic actor. He's a song and dance Broadway kind of performer. He does everything, but this is the thing that everyone loves him for. So I think at some point he'll come back and do that. I don't know how.
Probably.
But at some point they're gonna have to replace him, and that's gonna be a really, really tough thing to do.
Yeah, wasn't there some a while ago that he still has a say in who gets cast as Wolverine? Like, didn't Disney give them?
Didn't say anything about that. That's funny.
That let him not Disney. Maybe it was Fox or somebody that gave him a say in who he thinks he should take over the character. I don't know if that's still there with the Disney deal, but if that was the case, it'd be great if he did, because then, you know, if he approved it, everybody else would give the new guy the approval for it. Other movie stuff. Gittles and I were talking about this before the show. Candyman. Do you remember? Did you ever see the horror series Candyman from the 90s?
I never watched it, but I know what it is.
Yeah. So Candyman's getting rebooted. A brand new version of it is coming out next weekend. And Gittles was saying something about not watching the trailer. Your friend saw the movie in advance.
So here's the thing. My friend didn't see the movie in advance. My friend went to the movies because he's got that like AMC pass or whatever it is. And he's like, well, I'm using this until like movie theaters go out of business. So he went to go see Pig and he was just like, yeah, they showed the Candyman trailer. And like the first half of the trailer, he's like, is pretty good. He's like, and then like halfway through the trailer, he's like, it's just massive spoilers and plot points that they're giving out that you don't want to know. And he's like, and I could just tell. He's like, I haven't seen the movie, but I know that they should not have been showing that stuff in the trailer. So
right.
I'm totally not watching the trailer because I want to see Candy Dan on Tuesday or whatever. Candy Yams. That would definitely be an old O&A bit. Candy Yams.
Candy Yam, Candy Yam, Candy Yam, and then you just flooded with sweet potato and you die. That's just how it is. Yeah.
Just in the face. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I mean, I'm interested in it, but like, I'm not rushing out to see it right away. It was one of my favorite movies when I was a kid, or not, I won't say favorite movies. I will say it is the movie that scared the shit out of me the most when I was a child, because my sister was older than me and my cousin was older than me, and they used to like really fuck with me with like certain things.
He had a hook hand, right?
Yeah, he had a hook hand.
Yeah.
So you know the whole premise of the movie is like you say Candyman while you turn off the lights.
It was it was a take on the Bloody Mary thing where if you were at midnight and in a bathroom where the lights are off and you said Bloody Mary three times into the mirror, she would show up. That was essentially what would be with Candyman. He was sort of like a Freddy Krueger kind of thing. Like he was there, but then he wasn't. You had to summon him to I guess kill you. You're pretty much inviting. It's like death by cop almost. You know,
yeah.
It's like you're inviting him to come in and then he just comes and kills you. But he was an innocent guy, right? That got killed and then turned into Candyman or something.
Yeah, that like from the loose bits of the actual plot that I remember, that was it. But what I was saying was, so my sister and my cousin were like older than me, right? And I was probably 9 when Candyman came out, and they were probably around like 13, 14. And so they would do the Candyman thing in the bathroom, and they'd be like, oh, we're going to say Candyman three times and then turn off the lights.
Right.
But they did this at my cousin's house that he had just moved into, and I did not know there was a secret trap door in the bathroom that they could leave from. So they would do the Candyman thing, flip off the lights, hide in the thing, and then I would go in the bathroom and they were just gone. And I would freak the fuck out because I was like a 9-year-old kid. I didn't know what was happening. I thought there was some like actual Candyman murdering my sister and my cousin.
I have more questions.
And I had nightmares.
Why there was a trapdoor in the bathroom?
Eric,
forget
have you ever used the bathroom?
A trick on you, but why is there a trapdoor in the bathroom?
I don't know if it was like as much a trapdoor, if it was just like a hidden passage, like a clue thing, like behind like a cabinet. But yeah, and that like literally scared the shit out of me. And then I watched the movie recently, maybe like 5 years ago, and I was like, oh yeah, like this was a really dumb movie. I don't know why I was so scared. All
right. Finally, we have September 3rd, Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings, the latest Marvel movie, is coming out. I was going to ask if Zia is going to see it, but apparently she's taking a call at the moment. There's big news going on, I guess, on the butt kangaroo front that she's
She's making calls right now. She's like, we are on this butt kangaroo. Like, it's coming to Netflix soon, butt kangaroo, the show.
She's brokeraging a deal right now to make this happen. She's selling options already. They've bypassed us, her and Nick. They've already bypassed us with the idea. They're on it. They have the concept. They're selling it to Hollywood, and it's now going into development. We won't be seeing her no more.
Oh, no.
Not with a butt kangaroo. I don't know. She looks kind of panicked. You think everything's all right?
I think she's okay.
Okay.
She's sitting there. She's like, no, it has to be a butt kangaroo. What part of butt kangaroo don't you understand? The guy's like, all of it. I don't understand.
She's like, how fucking hard is it? You take the pouch, you put it on his butt, but the tail's there. So you move the tail. It's like under there. So essentially you're telling me he's hopping on his feet and the trapdoor compartment for his butt? Yeah. Or maybe it goes above the tail. You're the artist. You're supposed to figure this out, conceptualize it.
No, it's a butthole pouch, Eric. It's a butt kangaroo.
Okay.
And what it does is it leans back on its tail. Did you ever see like kangaroos do that? They can lean back on their tail, and he leans back on the tail, and that's how you get in and out of the pouch.
Right. I don't know.
Yeah, it's gross. It's very gross.
It'll be what it is. I want a part of the toy line. Like I want some back end.
Toy line.
I want some back end points on the movie, the toy line.
Yeah, back end.
So we got to. There you go. I want to ask her what the deal is now. She's coming back here on the show. Hi, Zia.
Hi.
Is that our painting?
Did you broker a deal for the butt kangaroo? That's what we were talking about.
Yes, it's going to cost us $20,000.
All right, I can do that.
We can
make me money.
We can do a crowdsource thing. Set up a GoFundMe. Everything all right? You were on the phone.
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine.
You sure? Where is?
Yeah.
Do people need to be corrected?
Oh, here it is. Here's a butt kangaroo. Here's the butt kangaroo. Help me suck the wet.
Yes, right. Open to say. Toy line writes just like George Lucas. Yes. Well, you can keep the movie points. We're going to take the toy line and make $11 billion. You're right, Didlotic. She didn't say no. She did not say no. So something's afoot. Strange things are afoot at the Anderson household.
We have a butt kangaroo.
All right.
You
sure you're okay?
Oh,
everything's wrong. It's going to be shit. I see what you did there. I laughed.
Butt kangaroo.
So we're ending with this. September 3rd is Shang-Chi, the latest of the Marvel movies coming out there. Are you going to go see it? I'm going to go see it.
I've got tickets already.
Yep. I have to buy my tickets, but I'm going to go. I'm not doing IMAX anymore. I'm doing that Dolby surround sound theater.
That's the best one.
Nice reclining seats.
They've got the good seats.
Everything's wired into your seat so you can hear the conversations behind you. You feel everything.
Best.
Yeah. If you could do that and the IMAX experience like that, then maybe I would go back to spending $30 a ticket to go to IMAX. But otherwise, I just spend two extra bucks and go to the Dolby thing and sit quite comfortably. No stadium seating for me. I'm above all that now. I am a fancy gentleman.
I'm with you on that. The Dolby theater is the best now.
Zia is also a fancy gentleman.
I'm a fancy gentleman.
Yes, we're going to get her a monocle and a top hat.
Gentleman lady.
Right.
Lady gentleman.
And Nick will be wearing spats with a cane in his butt.
So he uses gross. That to walk.
All right, let's get out of here and do the plugs.
R2-D2, he's just got like one, like three leg. He's just like scooting around.
With now I'm just picturing poo.
Yeah.
Everyone keeps stepping on R2 and just using him as a toilet and he's screaming. That's more of a visual for everybody. All right, let's do the plugs and get out of here. Zia, what do you have for us?
Follow me on the social medias. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Zia_Land. And then you can find all my links there to all the other things that I do. Also, please sub to my YouTube channel. I'm trying to get to 100 subs so I can put youtube.com/Zialand. Right now, it's just a bunch of letters and numbers and nonsense. So it's under Zialand. I do have my first video. The unboxing video is up. And yeah, thanks, guys.
And then run over and support her on her her fans page before they show her the door and she's gone.
Pieces of garbage. You're going to lose everyone. Like, that's such a dumb idea.
It is.
Like, nobody is doing legit. I mean, there are people doing legit stuff on that app, but they're not making money doing it.
Gills and I were talking, I think this was also before the show, that a lot of these women that do the OnlyFans, like, they do Chrissy Mayer's show a lot. So I hear their conversation and stuff. So you subscribe for their page, but then they do some sort of, like, pay-per-view thing, which is extra. It's like Disney Plus premium content on Disney Plus. Even though you're subscribed here, you pay a little extra, you get other shit. And that's where they do more of this stuff that I think OnlyFans is cracking down on. Like, they'll do more of their more risque or hardcore stuff, I think the article said, for what they want to get rid of, for these little pay-per-view things that you're spending extra money for. So it's like a paywall and then another paywall. Why
it's
is
so
that
stupid.
Such a, it's not like somebody can just accidentally come across this stuff. Why is that such a big deal?
Nah, I don't know.
And you're right. The majority of that platform, they can say, no, it's for comedians and bands and all that. No.
It's not.
90% of that business is all women and men doing, you know, some kind of you know, modeling or sex work kind of stuff. Not like prostitution, but, you know, like pornography, whatever you want to call it nowadays. But they're doing it for themselves as a ways to make a living, and you're going to, like, no, we're going to get rid of the majority of this. Then they don't get their money. They get a cut from all of that stuff, right? Don't they?
Of course, yeah.
So then they lose that money, too. It's fucking stupid.
Well, and it's the other people are just going to move to another platform. There already ones are other platforms that people have been using that they've, I think, I forget what the other one is, but they
only
you can
hands.
Pay with PayPal, and yeah, they're just doing things with their hands.
Only mans.
But anyway.
Lonely Pants.
Yeah, Lonely Pants. Join me at my Lonely Pants fan. Speaking of Lonely Pants, Gittles, what do you have to plug?
Gittlebase on the Twitter, Instagram, Xbox Live, and twitch.tv/Gittlebase. My ribs are almost fully healed, so Number of the Feast will be starting up again soon. Hopefully, probably in like 2 weeks. I want to give it one more buffer week of healing just to make sure I'm safe. But yeah, I'm going to be coming back. First episode back, I'm going to do ribs. So let's just, you know, go on theme.
Makes a lot of sense. Did Lodic saying only hands is specifically for that gyro hands kid.
Or if that's what he needs.
Or if that site doesn't work, he's also saying you can go to Pecker Pouch. Download that app and check out
Pecker
everything
Pouch
over
great,
at Pecker Pouch.
Great name.
For
the old banana hammock is now the Pecker Pouch.
The banana hammock district, you know.
Playing bananagrams.
For me, it's E-Rock Radio across the board on all the social medias, but more importantly, the show. It's Eric Nagel across the board on all the social medias. Like us on Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you're listening on the radio and you missed all the video stuff, all the videos are right there on our YouTube channel. And if you do want to join us live Thursday, 7 p.m. Eastern-ish, we're on twitch.tv/itsEricNagel, and the YouTube channel is streaming that as well. I think we covered everything, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm going to see potentially Gittles on Saturday, but definitely seeing Zia on Saturday, as we're going to go on an Asian shopping adventure. It's going to be a lot of fun. We'll have the details for that for next week. I think we're out of here. So until the next time, everybody.
Be excellent to each other.
And have a wonderful time.
And we'll be seeing you. Godspeed, Fez.
Eric Nagel.
Alas, we're out of time.
Follow It's Eric Nagel on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. For ways to listen to the show, go to itsericnagel.com. And remember to tell two friends so they can tell two friends. And they can tell two friends.
And they can tell two
and
friends.
Those two friends.
And those two friends.
And those two friends.
And they can tell two friends.
Well, you get the idea.
Keep it real, homies.